Okay, well, Cronulla, they've got into the spirit this week, and during the week they held a back to the 70s training night, and we thought who better to cover it for the footy show than one of the true greats from the 70s.
Well, it's 70s week in the NRL, and to celebrate, they're naming the 70s team of the decade. Got my fingers crossed. And today at Sharks training, the coach, Stephen Raper, has asked his boys to come along and dress in the 70s theme. And who better to show the boys what the 70s are all about than the bloke who won 8 Rothmans medals in a row, Reg Reagan. Let's go.
Well, boys, first of all, could I just say welcome. Welcome to training today. I watched the game the other night against the Roosters. I thought your performance was poofy and piss poor. So I received a call from your coach last night, Steve Raper, and he asked me to come here and address you. And we're going back to the 70s. And I see you want to dress like the 70s, you want to talk like the 70s, walk around like clowns like the 70s. Well, guess what, boys? There's a new sheriff in town today. We're going to train like the 70s, OK? Hey, Nuts, come here. Here, mate. Want a drink of water? Here, look at that. See that? Bang. That's 70s, boys. Let's get on the friggin' field, mate. Let's go. Come on, let's go. Come on, Zeus. Not the Waratahs, son. Let's go.
'70s were about, Steve-o. They even know.
They don't. 70s football was all about elbowing blokes in the back of their head while you're getting back on side, stepping on blokes' heads. I've tried to do that. I've tried to bring it back. But
I'll tell you what the 70s weren't about. They're not about this sort of stuff, Steve. So leave that sort of stuff. OK, leave it in the new millennium.
Hey, boys, just let me know when you're going to start putting in, right, huh? I mean, look at this.
Man, I've got to give you a rap. Some of the boys look great today, but your haircut, fair dinkum, Stewie, you've gone to the barber and got the 70s haircut. It just looks fantastic.
I knew he'd say something like that.
What does 70s mean to you, Nuts? What does that mean to you?
Big hits.
Big tits. Come on, hey, boys. I don't have to be anywhere. Let's go. Have the hands under the toes. The hexaborn is stretch. Up, stretch your legs. Don't even move your toes. Go!
Let me tell you about the 70s of Cronulla. It was about panel vans, it was about bleach blonde hair, and it was about bashing Westies. But what about you blokes last Saturday night? He's got beaten up by a bunch of gay bar loiterers from the eastern suburbs.
A few decisions didn't go our way from the referee.
A few decisions. Just didn't go our way. A couple more brace we could have won.
Bull s***! Skipper. What did you learn from today?
Oh, mate, obviously all the basics of the game.
That's what we used to do at noon in the old days. I said, back in my days, mate, we didn't have things like anabolic steroids.
Son, back yourself for once in your life. You think big BK Ben Kennedy's going to take a backward step against you?
No, I don't
think so. I taught him yesterday. He hates you. He hates you with a passion, son. Well, there we go, mission accomplished. You know, half of these kids here today weren't even born in the 70s. But I think thanks to Red Dragon, I've shown them what the 70s are all about. And what were they about? Well, they were about drinking piss, multiple partners, and bad cop shows. I'm Red Dragon.
Hey, good on you, Reggie. I tell you, you look good, mate. I mean, we're talking about 70, I mean, and the 70 side is going to be named later on when I cross that. I mean, is there a chance that Red Dragon will be named in that side?
I think the good thing about that piece, there won't be any complaints.
No one's
ringing the Channel 9 network at the moment saying...
Can you imagine?
Can you say those things?
Mate, now, listen, I just want a big thank you to the Cronulla people for letting us in, all the Cronulla Sharks, Stewie Raper, Steve Raper, and all the boys. Thank you very much. You're great sports.
Yeah, absolutely.
We're not too far away from a kick-off at Ericsson Stadium in Auckland on Super Saturday. The Warriors up against the Knights. Of course, both teams out of the running for the top eight. One of the few teams, or one of the few combinations we've seen in recent weeks, which won't have a bearing on the top eight, of course. But the Knights looking to avoid the wooden spoon. The Warriors have plenty to play for. For Stacey Jones with his last game.
Yeah, I think there'll be a big crowd over there in New Zealand to wish Stacey Jones all the best in his new venture when he goes to France next season. But there is a lot riding on it for the New Zealand, Newcastle Knights. Of course, Andrew John's looking to lift his side from the bottom of the competition table. They've never won a wooden spoon and they don't want to get it this year.
OK, let's hear from Knights coach now, Michael Hagan. He's speaking with Jason Costigan.
Well, Michael, a lot of hype concerning this one tonight, something that you're well and truly aware of.
Yeah, it's been, a big build-up for the game, especially for Stacey Jones in his last game, which we are pretty well aware of, and it's something that we can't control to a fair degree, and I'm sure they'll come up fired up tonight.
From a personal point of view, you've got a good record here. You've never lost, in fact.
No, it's something, that we've enjoyed some success here recently, and we seem to prepare well when we come to play the Warriors, and we enjoy playing against them. So I don't see tonight being any different to other times.
And the idea of not finishing last, how important is that? It seems to be brought up week in, week out at this stage of the season.
Yeah, I guess it's been spoken about a fair bit. I guess in the end, we can't control that either to some degree. I mean, we can continue to prepare well and play well in our games, which we've done for the last 6 or 8 weeks, but unfortunately other teams like South and Penrith have similar ideas, and they're both in good form as well.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Thanks. Okay, it's time for the toss now. Our referee is Jason Robinson and the captains, of course, Steve Price and Andrew Johns.
Steve Toss, Andrew Gore. Tail.
Head. Head, we'll run that way.
We kick him off.
Yep.
We're running this way.
Good luck, guys.
Andrew, your matchup with Stacey, obviously something you're going to look forward to tonight.
Yeah, we seem to bring out the best in each other, and it's a big occasion for Stace. You know, I hope he plays well, and I think it's going to be a great game tonight, so look forward to it.
On a personal note, if my maths are right, 53 points from your last three visits. Good numbers?
Oh, well, that's news to me. I sort of don't keep tally on it, but tend to score a few tries over here, but that's a few years ago, so I haven't crossed it much too much this year, but let's see how we go tonight.
We wish you well.
Thanks, mate.
Andrew Johns has scored a couple of tries during this run of form. They've had 6 of their last 8 games have been wins, of course, and he's set up plenty for the Newcastle Knights.
Oh, that's what you expect off Andrew Johns every time he participates in a game of football. I think it'll be a tough night for Newcastle. I think they'll put plenty of pressure on Andrew Johns, especially his kicking game. Big New Zealand forwards getting over the advantage line. Plenty of emotion attached to this game. I think it could be an upset if the New Zealand Warriors win.
We're not too far away from a kick-off there over at Ericsson Stadium. Make sure you stay with us for the Warriors and the Knights.
Well, from Matty Johns the Great to his brother the greatest, Andrew Johns, over there in Auckland last night. Absolutely sensational, this run from the Knights over the latter part of the season. The Warriors had enough ball and enough opportunities early in the game to lead by 20. They had missed opportunities, they had disallowed tries. Finally, they got on the board with this big young winger, 19 years of age, called Manu Vadavai. Is that how you pronounce it? Vadavai. Gee, he looks like a good player. But the Knights hung in there. They really did. In the second half, they were still down 4-0 with 20 minutes left to play. This is a disallowed try to Stacey Jones. We'll have a little bit more of a look at that later.
It's another disallowed try here, which I thought was a pretty tough decision.
Yeah, well, they were all video referee decisions. The video referee was very, very busy. And this is another disallowed try to Stacey Jones, where he reaches out. This is another disallowed try to Stacey Jones from instructions.
I think that's fair enough. I thought the first two in the first half were just stale tries.
Well, they could have scored 5 or 6 extra tries. Then all of a sudden, Andrew Johns from his own end of the field. Watch this pass. Watch this. Around the corner to Brett Tighe. A little bit of a touch, hold up, stop. You've been touched. But
it was a good touch.
Yeah, it was a good touch. And Brett Tighe races away. And from there, the floodgates seemingly open. And once the Knights got to the front, they didn't let go. Clint Newton here will force his way through some pretty brittle defence. And really the back half of the season there, Stacey Jones with Andrew Johns straight after the game. Disappointing end for Stacey Jones, who was playing his last game for the Warriors on home soil. And the Warriors said that they were going to lift for them. But Freddie, the Knights were just too good.
Mate, I thought it was sad. I thought Stacey Jones was excellent. His kicking game was great.
He tried hard, didn't he?
And he, what he did, he put enough pressure on Newcastle for the Warriors to win. They come up with about four or five no tries. And, you know, just come to a stage, Newcastle went bang, and that was the end of Warriors.
In his last ever game in New Zealand, Warriors skipper Stacey Jones had three tries disallowed against the bottom of the table, but informed Newcastle Knights. Andrew Johns and co ruining the farewell party with three late tries to win 16 points to four.
And ties away, tie the 5-8, forget about the chase. Newcastle will score their first try.
Now, we sent Matty Johns out of the streets of South Sydney to talk about wooden spoons.
Well, not long to go, people, and tell you what, there's a real ding-dong battle happening at the top of the ladder, but the real heavyweight struggle's happening at the bottom of the ladder. The battle for the wooden spoon, and 8 weeks ago, this thing was sent to Knights headquarters. But I tell you what, I'm so confident in the way Joey and the boys are playing. Today, I'm here to return it to its rightful place.
Hello, mate.
Good, mate, good.
Mate, you got a prediction for us for the wooden spoon?
Wooden spoon, I think the Knights are going to get it, mate, this year.
Wooden spoon, Newcastle.
Newcastle.
And what about those Rabbitohs at the moment, eh?
Mate, they're legends. That's my side.
Your side, eh?
Red and green heart, mate.
Been a Rabbitohs supporter, you probably know what this is, then, eh?
Them Rabbits, they're doing pretty good. They're all right.
Do you think they can avoid the wooden spoon? I mean, Newcastle are coming home with a wet sail.
I don't know. I think I know where you can stick that.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, I know, yep. Andrew Johns, I'm the best footballer in the world, darling.
I think your brother deserves the wooden spoon more than anyone, honey.
Yeah. I'll tell you what, you could break that wooden spoon over his big fat ass, couldn't you? Hey,
what, about the big fat head?
Yeah, oh, geez, that's a bit nasty.
Might run in the family too, eh, bub?
Oh, gee, yes, that's a bit nasty.
Well, you've come into Redfern to ask us about Newcastle. You're in a Newcastle jumper. Go back home, sweetheart. You deserve the wooden spoon.
Mate, why are they going so well, the Rabbitohs?
Mate, I think it's just there's a buzz around the whole area at the moment.
Sure is.
Yeah, that's a helicopter going up. Yeah, that's right.
Why are they playing so well, the Rabbitohs, at the moment?
No place to hide. No place to hide. I've seen rabbits run fast, but they're fast.
Give us a go, the Rabbitohs, Janet.
Okay.
Give us a go, the Rabbitohs, Janet, okay?
Yeah, I will.
Now?
What can I say?
Go to the Rabbitohs?
Yeah, go to Rabbitohs. Rabbitohs, up you go.
Let's pretend it's the last round and that, yeah, the news comes through that South Sydney haven't got the wooden spoon. How are you going to celebrate?
Ladies?
They'll be partying for a whole year, I think.
Well, show me how you party. Woohoo! Yay! Beauty!
Yeah, you can tell from the South Sydney fans it means a lot to avoid that wooden spoon, but they're not out of jail yet. The Knights are going very well, Chief.
It's not over yet.
Not over yet.
Okay, it was obviously a very jubilant coaching staff for the Sharks, and we caught up with Stuart Raper at the post-match conference because he wanted to pay tribute to a man who he felt was the difference last weekend for the Sharks.
So, Stuart, a bit of a turnaround from last week against the Roosters?
Yeah, it certainly was. Great performance by the guys. They turned it on when it was needed, and we scored some great tries.
Anything in particular you think?
Probably a lot of hard work we did through the week. We had a special extra there this week in the very noted rugby league identity, Reg Reagan, who helped us out with some great tips, and I've got him here to answer a few more questions by the press.
Thanks, Steve. A little understated, but by the way, nice haircut. Who cut that? The council.
Okay, let me ask you so-called experts a question. Who of you thought the Sharks were going last week? Go and get your hands up. Come on, Stu, get your hand up, hey? Well, let me tell you something, people. Go and have a look at the scoreboard. 68 points to 6. Sit on that and rotate, you big note wankers. Look, there's a story going around that today's victory was all about Reg Reagan. It's true. I mean, it's true. I've made Phil Gould in the past. I've made Ricky Stewart. And it'll come as no surprise to say that starting immediately, I've been offered the first grade coaching position here at Cronulla Sharks. And Stu, I've decided to accept, but your hard work won't go unnoticed. I've got the position for you. You go start the bus up and get me an ice cold beer. Now, go to the Sharky!
Well, there we go. I mean, I've got to ask Jason Rolls, does that strike fear that, you know, the team just over the bridge is in... have brought Reg Reagan. I mean, what can you guys do to counter that? Maybe Randy Discatelli, who knows?
Oh, I don't know, I think we need a miracle.
You've played under a lot of good coaches. Where do you think Reagan would fit into that?
Oh, he'd be in the top 2 or 3, top, probably. Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
200 or 300, I'd say.
We actually had a phone call from an old teammate of yours who was particularly upset that you were giving it away, and this is what he had to say.
G'day, Robbie. Bob. Mate, when I heard the news that you're retiring at the end of the season, well, I just couldn't believe it. Couldn't believe you're still playing, that is. I thought you retired 15 years ago, you played. Anyway, mate, I still remember the first time we met, way back in 74, playing for West. I was just a youngster coming into grade. You took me in, took me under your wing. I owe you a lot for that. Mate, you're a father figure, a mentor, a great friend, and on one notable occasion after too many beers, a fantastic lover. Anyway, mate, good luck for the future. You're a great friend. A shit footballer, but a great friend.
But for Newcastle, they are full of motivation ahead of tonight's clash with the Sharks. You see, the Knights, they are out to avoid finishing last on the ladder.
Being a leading player in a side bearing down on the wooden spoon is hardly ideal for anyone, but when you've skippered New South Wales to State of Origin glory, finishing at the bottom of the premiership pile is even more unattractive.
We can't take back what the run that we had at the start of the year. We can only finish off strong and hopefully never be in this position again.
Going into tonight's clash against a Sharks side fresh from a 62-point hammering of Manly, the Knights could be forgiven for having some doubts, but there's a very different mood in the camp.
Very enthusiastic at the moment. A lot of confidence in the team, so I'm really looking forward to these next two games.
The Knights have won their last 5 games among their Scalps top 8 sides, Parramatta, Melbourne and the Sea Eagles.
I think it's going to be one of the highest wooden spoon point tallies of history, so it's just going to show what the sort of competition it is.
Newcastle could be well represented on the end of season kangaroo tour. Steve Simpson in line to join Badiris and Andrew Johns.
Yeah, you play the game to play in the big games and you're not going to play in the semi-final series, so that'll be disappointing, but hopefully we can win the Tri-Nations.
While there'll be no September action, Newcastle hopes its late-season bubble doesn't burst tonight.
As you're speaking of finishing strongly, the Newcastle Knights, they've won their last 6, in fact, they've won 7 of their last 8, and we should point out that the loss in there was the Golden Point one to Cronulla.
Exactly right.
They could have strung together what the West Tigers have done.
Yeah, absolutely. Can we get a wild card? I reckon if we get a wild card into the playoffs, we can take it out.
So too for the Newcastle Knights, an unbelievable first half again, just blew the opposition away. The Sharks had no answer, and it's not just Andrew Johns.
It's not.
It's not, no, exactly.
There's players in the Knights that have been playing good all year, despite the bad loss at the start of the season. Players like Clint Newton, Craig Smith, Regan Tanner, these types of players have been putting their hands up all year. But they say if you're 7, you're 6, you're 9 and you're 1 are going well, the side's going well. And Andrew Johns, Danny Badiris, Milton Thaida and Kirk Gidley is back from a long injury have all been playing some great football in recent weeks.
Fair to say it's not just Andrew Johns, but I tell you what, he had a hand in most of their tries. And as you said, Daisy, there's a nice pass here from Johns. Danny Badiris also too. And a lot of Thaida as well was very good.
Look, all the other players around Andrew and Danny, if they're all doing their job and competing and doing what Michael Hagan expects from them, they're a chance of winning games. Whatever Andrew Johns and Danny Badiris are in the form that they're in at the moment, the Knights could beat anybody.
Gus, I saw the Sharks win a scrum 10, 15 metres out from the Newcastle line. They spread it to the back line. Steve Simpson made a try saver in the far corner near
Here's
the post.
Here's another one. He's been amazing.
That's the type of attitude that your senior players have got to have. You know, this Newcastle team on current form rate number 2 or 3 in the competition. You know, and when you consider in that string of wins, they did beat Parramatta along the way. You know, what could have been for them had John stayed fit and they'd not started the season as badly as they did. No. Going back to Andrew Johns, when you say, you know, it's not all Andrew Johns, and it's not. But as you saw in the Origin series, and as we've seen so many times with Newcastle, what he does is he ignites the talent in everyone else in the team.
Absolutely.
And what last night was, his first 40 minutes last night was as good as you could ever create. Not only that, on the Friday night before the Saturday night, I'm sitting here with his brother Matthew Johns having a beer in Brisbane. He's telling me where Andrew Johns is going to direct the attack and how effective it's going to be. Go back and watch the first half tries and watch what Andrew Johns does to the opposition defensive line and then how the talent takes over to take advantage of it. He absolutely destroyed them with planning, with preparation, and with perfection and execution. It was outstanding.
And sadly for Jason Stevens, it looks like he's dislocated his shoulder, and it could be the last time we see Jason playing for the Sharks. So that's a bit of a blow for the Sharks and also for Jason as well.
Yeah, that's a difference a week can make in rugby league. A huge victory for the Sharks the previous week. Got belted last night.
Also there was Campbell. For Andrew Johns. Well, he sighted again. He found it. Andrew Johns, 10 metres out. Steps straight to the left and five. He beats them all. Andrew Johns, a solo try that will probably turn the match. And he is his.
He's down in because what a try. Great individual effort. Andrew Johns. Like it wasn't dead.
And that's an Andrew Johns try from the 1997 semi-final series requested by Graham Harvey, who pleaded that we play it because the Knights won't be involved in this year's final series.
In Newcastle, Andrew Johns led the Knights to their sixth straight win with a dominant performance against the Sharks. Newcastle fighting to avoid the wooden spoon and winning 44-14.
He deserves it. Andrew Johns deserves that try.
A painful loss for Cronulla prop Jason Stevens, who dislocated his shoulder and will have tests tomorrow.
The Sharks also have problems. Jason Stevens dislocated his shoulder while Brett Camorley spent the evening arguing with referee Steve Clark.
Out of my face. I'm allowed to out of my face.
He also lost the battle of the halves as Andrew Johns orchestrated the Knights' sixth straight win.
Clint Newton scores the try. Andrew Johns sets it up again.
Even his coach couldn't believe it. Michael Hagan's hope now that the Sharks recover in time for their showdown with South Sydney so Newcastle can avoid the wooden spoon.
Have they been the rubbish next week?
Time to fire some quick questions. Andrew Johns will win the Dally M Best Player Award next Tuesday night. True or false? Steve Ricketts.
True, Andrew Johns was about 11 points off the money when he got injured, but look, he's surely got the maximum 3 points in every game since his comeback. That's about 8 or 9 matches. I think he'll just have enough to tip the likes of Ben Kennedy and Scott Prince out the back door, and he will get a third Dally M award.
G'day, Fatty.
Well, Mr. Vorton.
Glad you could make it back for him in a little holiday. See, a lot of stories going around, man, one of which had lain on a beach in Vanuatu. Someone else told me you're drinking kava in Fiji. A person even came around and told me you got caught with tablets and barley. Crazy! I'll tell you what, mate, it's good to have you back. There's been a lot of pressure on Reggie. You've been carrying the show. Those other three clowns just won't shut up. Anyway, mate, good to have you back. Let's catch up, have a beer and a massage. Good luck.
Thanks very much, Reggie, good boy. And thanks to all those Channel 9 employees who said some kind things.
Now, we are 5 weeks out from the grand final, so what we did this week, we got everyone together on the footy commentary team, and we also included Jack Gibson and the like, to come up with what we felt were the best five grand final moments over the last...
Since 1990, yeah.
15
since
years.
Sort of got
exactly
footy
right.
Back on channel
very,
one.
Very tough choice. So we've put them all in together and we've sort of averaged it all out. So over the next 5 weeks, we're going to count them down. Tonight, we're going to have a look at what we believe is the fifth best moment in grand finals over that 15 years.
The top five grand final moments. Number five.
Langer away for Renoff. Renoff, we haven't seen much of him today. Now take a look at him as he crosses the halfway. They won't catch him. He's heading for the corner and he's over. Renoff makes it 22 points to 4.
A champion side, nobody can deny that.
The same thing with all my tries. I never really thought about it, the impact of them straight after the event. It was always a bit, you know, a week or two later that, you know, you sort of realise, oh, geez, I did that.
They've won the Winfield Cup for the first time.
I was very, very tired. Any further than I think Ricky would have got me. But Alpha actually told me to stay down and not get up. But mind you, he picked up on me afterwards.
Good on you, Fatty. Have a good show.
Fatty, can't wait to see you back in the footy show. It hasn't been the same without you.
Fatty, it's good to have you back from all the South Sydney supporters. All the best. And keep doing what you do best.
Fatty, it's great to you better. Have a great show.
Good luck, mate. You're never forgotten. Up Manly.
Good Manly supporter, good man.
Hi, Fatty. Great to see you back. Yeah, the other boys are hopeless.
Good to see you back, Fatty. That's cold.
Fatty, it's great to see you back. I hope your brain's okay.
Good on you, Fatty. Good to see you back, mate. I'm feeling better.
Cheers. Hope you're doing well. And welcome back from all the Seagulls supporters.
Fatty, good to see you back. Eels to win.
Good on you, Fatty. Great to see you back.
That's go.
And Fatty, it's lovely to see you back and have a good chat.
Great to have you back, Fatty, on the footy show. There's some flowers for you. Get all quick.
Fatty, it's so good to see you. We've missed you and it's great to have you back. The show hasn't been the same without you. Welcome home.
Wonderful to be back. Yes, excellent work. Now, of course, having been off injured for a long, long time, it was great to see the best player in the game re-establish himself as just that. Let's remind ourselves before he comes on to the footy show tonight about how good he is.
Short kick. Johns into open space. Here's Johns putting a kick in. Ball is hitting down, running down, try. It's a try for the Blues.
Johns,
dummy.
And here he comes, the invincible, Andrew Johns. What's doing, champ?
Not much. Thank God you're back. Show's been a shambles. This bloke's been out of control.
Oh, he's good. He's been good.
Thanks, Fat. Appreciate it.
You reckon?
I'll tell you what, time for a bit of a square up. I mean, can we just go back to the intro of Joey? Just have a look at you. Talking, bouncing up and down on the sideline. Have a look at this. Now, look at this. Mate, that is Willy Wonka and the chocolate. You're an Oompa Loompa. Mate, you are a dead set Oompa Loompa. Look at that.
Mate, you can come around home. I've got 20 of those jerseys. I think you've only got two of them. One nil.
Couple of those ones. White flag. Gone.
Yeah. I think you were telling me earlier they had 14 and 15 on the back room too. Mate, your form has been outstanding. We're trying to work out since you've come back from your jaw whether you, apart from the going to extra time against Cronulla, whether you've actually been on a losing side.
I think against Brisbane, the first game back, we got dusted. So ever since then, it's all been rosy. So.
And even though you're not going to be in the finals this year, I would imagine that the confidence from the finish of this year to take into next year, like Brad Tye, Trent Salkeld, Clint Newton's gone to a new level, really something to build on in 2006.
Definitely. It gives us something to work hard in the summer. It was dire straits at the start of the year. The confidence was all over the joint, both as myself and the rest of the team. But give us a great base now. We've got some great additions next year. Brian Carney from England's coming over. Matty's a good mate. Luke DeVico also to strengthen our forward pack. So there's no reason why we'll be a top four team next year, and everyone's buzzing. The club's buzzing, the town's buzzing. Looking forward to it.
And I think Milton Thaiday, I think he has been seriously one of the signings of the season. Like, looking outside the box, I mean, Kennedy's been outstanding, but Milton Thaiday, I mean, how good a footballer is he?
Well, he gives us some brilliance we haven't had in the back line. Also with Brad Tye, where nothing's on, you can throw him the ball and they can create something out of nothing. Milton's been outstanding. Didn't have an off-season at all. He tells me when he was playing for the Waratahs, he was 10 kilo heavier than what he was now.
A little like Matt Dunning, actually.
So with an off-season of weights and the 3 or 4 months of hard running, he could be anything next year.
What about an old stager like Craig Smith? Oh, he's been great for the club since he's come.
He's been a great leader too. I suppose I'm not much of a talker before the game, but Smithy gets in there and has a lot to say to the young guys, especially the forwards. On the field, he's played every game since he's come to the club and been one of our best players. He's played again next year. You know, thank God. Yeah. And it's been great for the club. One of the, Matty's talking about Milton. He's been just as important as Milton.
Absolutely. I think another one is Cleet Newton. He's gone outstanding. He's improved every game.
I hope he's not watching that when you know you're giving him a rap.
A little bit of a rap there.
He's gone bald.
I've got to ask you.
And what would be wrong with that?
He's 21.
We've got to mention that Cleet Newton is Jennifer Hawkins, and he's a shambles, mate.
He's got to concentrate on his football. But I want to ask you about this year. How do you class it? It's been a tumultuous one, but for the club and for you, how does this fit in? How do you class it?
Early on, I spoke before, it was dire straits. The first five games I was playing was probably the worst I've played, or was the worst I've played my whole career. Come back from the knee injury, and then obviously broke the jaw, and then come back, and then it's all sort of clicked into place. I think we've won, I don't know how many we won, 8 out of 9 games or something. So it's been, on top of that, with the Origin football, it's been one to remember.
And off the field too, the Knights doing a bit tough, like financially. The whole thing went round a circle, hasn't it?
Yeah, well, when Colin Allard came on board, it seemed to coincide with the improvement of the side. So, sponsors have jumped on board. There's new confidence within the place, both on and off the field. So it looks good for the future.
Competitor like yourself, I'm sure, would be looking forward to Sunday out at Oakey Jubilee up against the Dragons. And it's remarkable to think that second up against the bottom team at the moment, you guys are almost favourites in this one with the kind of form you're in. Looking forward to it?
Yeah, I've been looking forward to it. I suppose I've been looking ahead a little bit. There's no better player in the competition now in Trent Barrett. I think he's playing some great football. And right across the park, I think they're worthy favourites for the competition, St George. So we're going in quietly confident. I think we'll give them a real show, but they're going to be tough to beat. They've got no weaknesses across their board. There's no weak defenders, and when they get a roll on, they're hard to stop. But the way we're going, I think
they're a great side, St George. They're in form, and I think you blokes are the form team of the comp. But if Parramatta beat Brisbane on Friday night and get the minor premiership, do you think that'll affect the Dragons' mindset at all?
No, I don't
it shouldn't.
So. No.
It shouldn't. Yeah. They can't do better than second.
I'm interested to see what the bye does to them. Because the bye can halt your momentum. It really can. I'm interested to see, what the bye has done to them. And I think if I watch them play at Parramatta, St George, I think if they're vulnerable to anything, besides the go at them hard. I think when Parramatta move the ball, they look good. But Joey, what about your week?
They reckon they've been training hard during the bye. Trent Barrett was training hard. And
lots of push-ups, they reckon.
A lot of push-ups, they reckon.
Speaking of Trent Barrett, of course, he has been in the news, and our man on ground, Denny Widler, has caught up with Trent to ask him about doing push-ups in his red Grundies and also about taking on Joey Johns.
My behaviour was obviously inappropriate. The club's dealt with it. It was a bit disappointing the way things turned out, but I just want to really concentrate on the footy now and put it behind me and go out, and it's important for me to play well against Newcastle this week and the team to win.
Joey's been carving everybody up. It's going to be hard.
Yeah, it will. I watched him again yesterday, and I don't know if I've seen him play with more control or better. He's really choosing his times, when to run. He's probably only running 3 or 4 times, but he's making breaks or scoring tries, and we've got to work out a way to stop him. But I think leading into the semis, it's going to be good practice for us, I guess, playing against who I think is the best player in the world, and we're probably not going to come up against another Andrew Johns in the semis, so it's going to be a good test for us and good practice, I think.
I'll tell you what. I don't know what you blokes think, but for mine, the $2,000 fine and all the media fuss around Trent Barrett doing some push-ups in his underpants is the most farcical thing. It was the biggest non-event. I'll tell you, back when I played, if I'd done push-ups in my underpants, someone would give me $2,000. I mean, it's fair thing, it should be applauded. But now, seriously, political correctness gone mad.
It has. I mean, look, 25 years ago, end of season drink, we just stand around the bar at the Stain completely in the nude and drink for about 3 hours. Luckily, there was no cameras around, no papers, and those times. Times have changed, and probably for the better.
Hey, Joey, I've got to say to you, like both teams, you won 6 games in a row. It's a big game, but it must be a wonderful thing or a thought, the fact that Knights may not get the wooden spoon if you win, and also you're leaving, the next day to go to England for another challenge? It'd be a good way to leave.
Yeah, it's given me a kick along the last sort of month of the season. It's something I've always wanted to do. I've sort of spoke about that, but just can't wait to get over there, and I just need a change at the moment. you know, I've had a real busy couple of weeks. So.
Did you watch this game? That one of the big games at the end of the English season is the Challenge Cup. The Premiership is very similar to this.
I watched it really close on the other night. I can't believe how open the footy is. They just throw it around. There was 90,000 people here going crazy.
What an atmosphere, that's outstanding.
And, you know, the game was one of the best ever. It's won the last 2 minutes. And actually, when I go over the first 2 weeks, I play Leeds on the Saturday night and then follow up and play Hull the next Saturday. So it's going to be
One of the most amazing things, Joey, is that you're leaving the next day. I mean, a lot of people talk about you missing possibly a kangaroo match, but, I mean, you're missing Mad Monday. I mean, you got anything planned for the flight or anything?
It's probably one of the biggest disappointments of my career that I'm missing Mad Monday. I always end up getting Dally M points on Mad Monday, but I'll dress up as a girl and get on the plane and... take on Boonies.
Well, don't forget there's a couple of blokes on this panel that I know of who've had some money on Warrington to win it, $26. So if you can get them home, there might be something for you, Joey. Matt, won't there?
Fatty, that's gambling.
Now look, when I was sitting at home, Crook the other day, I was watching a game and I saw this incident. Marco Mueller, the boy's coming out of the tunnel, and just watch, there's the ball boy. Brand new haircut, and he just bumps into him accidentally, of course. And that poor little chap must have got a massive fright having Marco Mealy come from behind. But then we've got Matty Johns, right? Matty is a good man, and we found the little ball boy and sent out a mate of Matty's to just check in with him.
So, son, just tell Reggie Boy what happened again.
I was leading the team out, and then I got up to there, and I don't know what hit me. Yeah, just a couple of broken ribs, I'll get over it.
Why don't you just point him out for me? Oh, the fat guy there?
Yeah.
Hey, tough guy, have a nice day. You recognise this kid?
No, not really.
What about this? Do you recognise that? Well, this is the kid you nearly killed on the weekend, and I, my friend, are your worst nightmare. Here we go, just get on one. That's it, son. Come on, don't let up, son. That's the way. Come on, help me. Come on, let's go and get a milkshake, son. Proud of you, son.
Reggie.
Good on you, son. Well done.
What a hero to the people, Reg Reagan
Reggie's
is.
Reggie's a great man. What a man.
Just a great man. Doesn't condone violence at all, kids, but... square up.
Okay. Now, Pete, the Jim Beam trivia, I've got 10 out of 10 right in the last 10 weeks.
All right, well, we'll put it to the test tonight. It is time for our Jim Beam trivia question, and it does feature Andrew Johns, seeing he is amongst us. And the question is, when did Andrew Johns make his first grade debut? When he did, against the Gold Coast in 1993. Who was the Seagulls captain? Was it A, Peter Gill, B, Ray Herring, C, Brendan Hurst, or D, Brent Todd? Now, if you know the answer to that one, you can call that number, 1902-555-225.
I know the answer.
Or text ABC or D to that number there. You've got till 11 o'clock tonight. Any chance of me finishing explaining this to people?
Mate. I just know the answer, OK?
You know the answer, do you?
Yeah.
OK, well, who is it?
Toddy.
Matt, Chief, I'm going to give one of my all-time favourites, Peter Gill Figowitz.
Okay. One of the great players of the 90s, Ray Herring. He was the captain.
He was a hooker, wasn't he, Ray Herring? Yes.
As we go to our second break of the night, please, a big cheerio, and thank you very much to Andrew Johns. Yeah. Thanks, Joe.
Okay, speaking of retirement, and we mentioned it last week, an emotional home farewell for a couple of excellent players and good friends of this show. Mark Hughes, who's been an absolute...
3 games for New South Wales, 2 grand final hero for the Newcastle Knights. The boys had a big win for him. He was ushered out in a fantastic way, held in the highest esteem for Newcastle.
Our last honour for the year, we've said all year, if you can't toast them, roast them. So we roast. Who's an Overcastrian here? Here is the wooden spoon. If you could pass it on, Matty, to your brother this afternoon. The wooden spooners, and there we go. There we go. A nice way to finish the Sunday race. Thanks for your support right through the year. Been a lot of fun. Thanks, MG.
Thank you,
Matty.
Thanks,
thank you, Paul. Stand by for the Sunday footy show with Sterlo and the team. See you later.
The Knights, unfortunately, well, probably the best performed team that we've seen win the Wooden Spoon, although the Chief is trying to tell me that the Raiders can still get it if The Knights beat the Dragons by something like 60. 50. I think.
No, that's right. It's actually 52 points. It's just a shame that it is inclement weather in Sydney because they'd go have a much better chance. But
I've got to say right from the top, I don't think we should hand out a wooden spoon this year. I think that the teams at the tail end of the competition have been too good to brandish anyone with that little bit of cutlery because it's just not fair.
So, but I think at the end of the year, they're playing fantastic, but Newcastle didn't win a game till round 16.
You just want to give them the spoon.
Well, it's got to be a spoon. A spoon's been given out forever, so we don't want to ruin this tradition.
If it's wooden spoon, is it cutlery?
No, I don't know if you can call it cutlery.
Now, we go out to Oakey Jubilee later this afternoon to, I guess, the two form teams in the competition, the Dragons and the Knights. They both won six in a row. It's a great contest. Wonderful players out there to view. It hasn't been a good season for the Newcastle Knights, but Tim Gilbert went out and caught up with some of their people just to find out what they think of their chances in 2006.
Here goes Johns again. Great short form. Clint Newton scores the try.
It'll be a tougher off-season than normal, do you think?
Oh, I hope not. Last off-season was hard enough for me.
The season's been turned around, you know, by our administration with Steve Crowell and Chief re-signing, you know, most of the guys who were coming off, so everything's looking good for next year so far.
Can you win the comp next year?
I'll be thereabouts again. I think if we're healthy and we've got a fairly strong squad next year, I'm pretty confident that we've got a lot of young blokes that played first grade and blokes that probably haven't played much footy at all that should come back next year. Blokes like, you know, Daniel Abraham hasn't played any football, Josh Perry, so really looking forward to seeing those blokes get on.
Yeah, definitely a tough time to play footy at the club, I suppose, but I suppose every club goes through them times from time to time, so thank God we're coming out the other side and everything's, yeah, looking brighter for next year, definitely.
Welcome back to the Sunday Footy Show. Fairly wet and cold and windy here at Oakey Jubilee Stadium for what should be a wonderful game between the Premiership favourites and the Wooden Spooners, if you can believe it. Now, just having a look at this team news, Albert Torrens won't play first grade today. Rhys Simmons comes into the side. He'll probably play on the wing. Wes Naguama will go back into the centres. Ashton Sims expected to drop out of their 18-man squad. That's for St George. Now, for the Knights, George Carmont comes into the side. They're expecting Matty White to drop off there. Not exactly knowing yet where George will play, but he could come into the side, into the centres. Now, it's always very interesting when a player comes up against his old side. It'll be no different for Michael Ennis this afternoon, a proud Nova Castrian, and he's looking forward to taking on the Knights.
Last time we played them, they didn't have Joey or Bedsy and Simon. Those blokes were at Origin, and we were without ours. So they're playing great footy at the moment, and I'm sure they'll let me know.
Do you miss Newcastle?
It's a great place, and we had the bye last week, so it was good to get back there, and I caught up with a few of the boys, and it's a beautiful place, and you do miss that, but I'm really enjoying my time at Saints. It's been really good, and I'm really enjoying it, yeah.
Now, Newcastle can avoid the Wooden Spoon with a very, very unlikely 52-point win today over St George. So to be fair to say, they're going to end up with the Spoon, but they've got so much to play for this afternoon. They've been in wonderful form the last couple of months. They want to take that confidence into 2006. But the Wooden Spoon, they're just going to have to live with it.
We can't change the past. If we get the spoon, we get the spoon. Our main objective after that is never to get it again. And so, you know, we'll win that, but nothing that you want in your trophy cabinet. But if that's the way it is, that's the way it is, and push on for next year.
Now to finish up around the grounds on Father's Day, a human story with a wonderful ending. Milton Thaiday, the fullback for the Newcastle Knights, he had a much publicised problem earlier in the year with alcohol. He spent time in a rehabilitation clinic, and it was really tough for Milton. His career with the Waratahs in rugby finished, and the Knights, well, they gave him a lifeline. Things are good now, both on and off the field. He's back with his wife and his little daughter, Milton Thaiday. What a wonderful player. As we go to the break, he's been in great form for the Knights.
How did you get through those tough times with alcoholism?
Probably just the support that I had, the little support I had in Sydney, plus my family would be on the phone nearly every night to me. Just the support network, that was the biggest thing that that helped me get through it, and along with a few of the counsellors that I had to see every day.
Now you're flying high. What sort of advice would you give to other people in that position, particularly young people?
Probably just to think before they act. You know, that's one thing that I didn't do. And consequences were, you know, getting in trouble from alcohol. But think before you act. That's the biggest thing I could say to people. You can't run away from it, otherwise, you know, it'll just keep chasing you. So, you know, just stand up and deal with it.
John's inside thigh day, into a yawning gap. Turns the ball back on the inside to Mullen. Mullen back to thigh day. He is going to score a sensational Newcastle try.
Don't let the weather put you off if you're thinking of going out to Oakey Jubilee Stadium this afternoon. I'm sure the game will warm your hearts. Two sides that are in excellent form, pointed out earlier, they both won their last six straight. No losses, 12 games between them. And as Tim Gilbert's pointed out, there are a couple of changes there. These are the name side, but we believe that no Albert Torrens there. In fact, Wes Naguama will go into the centres and Rhys Simmons probably onto the wing. And such is the strength of that lineup, Gus, they can leave a young player like Ashton Sims, who we think will drop off that bench. It's just a great playing personnel.
They're going good. I actually spent some time with Trent Barrett on Friday doing an article with the Sun Herald, and he was saying that they've had a good preparation for this game. They're coming off the bye and they're playing against Andrew Johns and the Knights, who probably rate as the number three team in the competition at this particular point in time. And they're going to get no better defensive examination than what Andrew Johns will throw at them today. Even though it's raining, I mean, when it's fine and the field's fast, it's easy. But when it's raining, the really good players do stand up even more. And I think that Andrew Johns has got enough weaponry to really fire off some shots at this St George Illawarra side. I think every coach in the finals will be watching to see what Andrew Johns does and sees in this Dragons defence. I rate them the best defensive team. I rate him the best attacking player in the competition. What a battle.
Well, Chief, what about the week in Newcastle and how much the disappointment of last night's South Sydney victory, does that have any influence as well?
Look, it does. For the record books, it does. And I'd be lying to say if that wasn't the case. But the mindset is that we want to test ourselves. We want to test ourselves against the best. We've won six in a row. Look, we can always justify things saying we had so many players missing games. It was just phenomenal, one of those things. Now we've got a few players back, we're performing well. But we need to know how we're going for next year. We want to judge ourselves.
Okay, well, it is our television game, 4 p.m. And it does have a fair, I suppose, influence on where the Dragons are going to finish. As I say, the Tigers could finish as high as second or fourth. The Dragons, that will decide where they're going to finish as well.
Hello, folks. Boots and all time and some classic rugby league for you today. This is the episode we've titled The Best. And we've come along to Telstra Stadium, the venue, Gus, where we play some of the biggest and best matches every single year. What about the bowling today?
The bowling's pretty special. We've got a semi-final. Scott Donald the Trump up against Sideshow Bob Matt Peterson. We're going to get to the countdown on how you viewers voted on our 10 most memorable moments on Boots and All. But I thought we'd start the show with the biggest hits of the last 20 years. Strap yourself in for this lot.
Lines, Kosov.
Oh! Massive hit! That's the biggest hit of the season so far.
And Ken Sutcliffe is next with sport. And at last, Kenny, we know who the final eight are, huh?
Mike, we have the finals draw plus the last round results as the Knights take the Dragons to the wire in a second-half thriller. The top eight is now set in stone with Parramatta taking the minor premiership and the Knights the wooden spoon, although they didn't play like that against the Dragons this afternoon. Last night, the Sea Eagles secured a final spot, the Cowboys just beat the Storm, and the Rabbitohs upset the Sharks. Today, the Panthers defeated the Tigers, the Roosters thumped the Bulldogs, while the competition favourites received a real jolt from Joey John's Knights, the Dragons home by eight. Andrew Johns was nailed early, but it was the Knights who scored first. There was bravery under fire, Tide stopping Riles inches from the line, but the red and white train was on a roll. Approaching half-time, the Dragons went 22-6 in front. An ankle injury still couldn't completely nullify John's brilliance, handling twice for this try.
Super tight.
Barrett took a heavy knock. Was this really a team at the bottom of the ladder as they got within two of the competition favourites? Riles gave the Dragons some breathing space.
Away for Riles.
And then sent up Barrett's hotel misdemeanour with a push-up. John's and Barrett had a debate. The Knights scored again and bombed one other before the Dragons limped home.
And a player all the finalists are delighted won't be featuring this year is now on his way to England. Andrew Johns is expected to play his first game for Warrington this weekend.
Get over there Tuesday morning, start training, I think, that afternoon. So hopefully get to know her pretty well.
Clinton Fletcher, National 9 News.
I wanted to have you say about the Dally M's tomorrow night. Who's going to win? We'll only just go for the player of the year.
Oh, well, I would think Joey would win. Joey Johns, I mean, he was in front when he was injured. And since then, they've won, what, 7 out of 9 games, and he's been the dominant player in every one of them. I would think he'd have
what
to
about
win.
Ben, I don't think he was in front when he was injured. But the thing about Joey, look, all it's going to cost him the Dally M is games played. If he played a full season, he would have won by the length of the stroke. Mm-hmm. Whether the injury, the broken jaw is enough to sort of prevent that, we'll wait and see. I think Ben Kennedy is right up to his teeth in this.
BK's had an enormous year. Yeah. He has been good every single game he has played. There hasn't been a down period in his season. He's led that forward pack, and look, okay, Manly are a bit undermanned. They probably don't deserve to be in the eight, only that they've got a couple of players like Ben Kennedy.
Yeah, he's had a massive season.
In fact, a side which hasn't gone very well and has got one player who stands out has got more chance of producing the player of the competition than a team that's got about eight players who share their
own. I told you, Kenny, if you give him time, he'll come up with something.
And if Newcastle hadn't lost 15 in a row and won some of those early games, they'd be in the final series.
Can I just say this? I was at this game yesterday with the Newcastle, and I actually did the Dally M points. I'm not going to tell you who I gave the points to. But what I will say is that if Andrew Johns was not in that game, it would have been a 40-0 result to St George Illawarra, because he kept Newcastle in that. He was in everything. He was on one leg for half the game. For more than that, injured his leg in the fourth minute.
It's a shame he's gone now, isn't it? That we won't see him. That the paying public won't be able to see the best player in the game for the next 2 or 3 weeks, because they're going to see a bunch of lemons running around.
They will in England.
Not for long.
Okay, now you wanted a new rule, Wiz?
Oh, give it to me,
Warren. Here we go. This is a groundbreaking program, as you've already said.
It's unbelievable.
Once again tonight, we'll bring in a new rule, and the rule is white boots will be banned in the NRL. And the reason for the ban is what happens right here. Plenty of people have had a comment about Colin Best putting his foot on the line and the touch judge missed it. Well, the reason he missed it, Colin Best and his white boots, you can't see. You can't see if it's a boot, it's a white line. Mm. We've got to ban white boots, Wiz.
Yeah, well...
The poor touchy.
Mate, you can't say that his hair got in his eyes anyway, that's for sure.
I think that line's been used.
Has it? Well, I didn't know that. I hadn't heard that one before. I thought he just chucked that in, didn't we? I cannot believe that he was looking down at the line where Colin Best's foot was and he didn't pick it up. It's got me... I cannot believe that. But then, like I say... Maybe the video referee should have come in and said, you've got that wrong at the next play of the ball.
Oh, at the next play of the ball? You want the NFL?
Well,
you want the National Football League.
What does that happen if that was in the grand final? What are they going to do?
It happens in the grand final.
They're the mistakes that we can't afford to have.
That's very true. And I'm sure it will cost perhaps...
Absolutely.
Because at the end of that set, the Dragons were upfield, they scored a try, and that could have been a big play in the context.
The turning point of the
game. And it could have been. Newcastle could be sitting there saying, this has ruined our season. If they won that game, they had a made eighth position, they would have been sitting and screaming, did I?
That's hypothetically, absolutely. Of course.
Yes.
Now, don't forget about the Dally M Awards, which will be brought to you live on Fox Sports tomorrow night. It's going to continue on, isn't it, this
game? Oh, don't worry about that.
Of course, 8:30 Eastern, Fox Sports 1, the Dally M Awards from the Sydney Town Hall. The Night of Nights will all be there in our black and white, looking absolutely glorious. And, of course, Andrew Johns, he's a chance to make it 4 Dally M titles, hypothetically. And, of course, he makes his UK Super League. Nothing hypothetical about this unless he gets injured, of course. In the meantime, or doesn't something happens with a plane it's being quiet. Late or being delayed or God knows
Let's
what.
Let's call a truce, Warren, and just get on.
I think we might. Warrington versus Leeds is what we're telling you about. 5 a.m. Sunday morning to 7 o'clock. We'll have it for you. The big debut of Andrew Johns playing in the UK Super League. We will get enormous ratings to watch that game, Wiz.
I will be up there, glued to the set, coffee in hand, a little bit of breakfast, watching that game.
You have an old TV.
Mate.
You went like that. You sort of did the old turn the knob on the TV. No. They haven't had TVs like that for 20 years, have they?
No, I've still got one.
Just they haven't been maybe
you
New Zealand still.
Put out the garage?
Hey, for in New Zealand, they've still got them.
You know when you get put out in the garage when you're in the dog box? I just got the old little one there. Yeah.
You're allowed to have an old,
on this.
Yeah, you're allowed to have one of those out in the garage. Yeah. That's the only place.
Yeah, that's
though.
The only way.
Andrew Johns had an unwanted travel accessory as he headed out for Warrington in the English Super League. It's no secret he'd prefer to be leading his Knights to an NRL title.
Devastated. I think even after performance yesterday was
The guys were so brave. Half time, we could have threw it all in, but we fought back and could have still won the game against probably the red hot favourites.
Is it possible, because it's never been done before, that a player who could collect the wooden spoon and also the Dally M in the same year?
Well, I guess if it's possible, Andrew Johnson's a chance of doing it.
We both come from Taree and grew up in the Group 3. Not only do our parents both live in Foster, we have something else in common. Do you know what it is?
What is that, mate?
We both have a wooden spoon.
The Peter Frelingos Memorial Award.
Go a little wider. Prince ball back for Marshall. The footwork, the footwork. Benji Marshall, now the speed. The footwork again. Away from Peachy. That is as good as you will see on a Sunday afternoon anywhere in the National Rugby League. Benji Marshall has sent the Tigers fans into a frenzy.
Puts the kick in. Bowen trying to get to it on the full, takes it and is called to play on. He was in the field of play. What a pass for Ty Williams. And look at Williams go. He runs from in the end goal area. He comes to Brett Stewart. Fullback on winger. Williams with a bend. Stewart hanging on. He gets away from him and will score for the Cowboys. What a run by Ty Williams. The greatest run so far in 2005.
There's Johns. He's the X factor. How will he come through? Some say he shouldn't be there on his limited preparation. Others say he had to be there. Here's Johns putting a kick in. It's a try for the Blues. Scored by Minicello. Struck it well! It's there! In front of the Eastern Grandstand. And the kick on its way. I think he's got it again. Yes! The flags are up again! Johns, the legend, is kicking magnificently. Dummies! He breaks the line! Johns has gone to the 20. Johns looks inside then. Runs again! Johns is in space! The nearest goes to Johns. Up his right foot, try!
Ladies and gentlemen, Matt Frelingos.
The Peter Frelingos Memorial Award for Headline Moment of the Year goes to... Andrew Johns.
Well, Andrew, of course, joins us live from the Halliwell Jones Stadium in Warrington, England. Andrew, thank you for being available tonight. And first off, how was the flight?
Yeah, it was a piece of cake. 28 hours.
Did you manage any sleep on that long flight?
Yeah, got a little bit, mate. It still knocks you around a little bit. I don't know. I think it's midday here, but it feels a whole lot later. So it took me a couple of days to acclimatise, but... it's on Saturday night, so I look forward to it.
Now, it's hard to imagine, but as we speak, of course, about the award you just won, the Peter Frelingos Award for the best moment of 2005, you spoke about that game too, the Origin Series, and being absolutely terrified before the game. It's hard to imagine you having that much doubt before a game of football.
Yeah, I was terrified. It was only my second game back from when I broke the jaw, and you know, I suppose I had question marks whether I was still up to that level, but it all... turned out to be a bit of a fairy tale, really, but one to remember, definitely.
You must have hid those doubts very well, because all the reports coming out of training camp for New South Wales in the lead up to that game was that you had slotted back in as if you'd never been away.
Oh, I don't know, mate. I was running on a bit of enthusiasm there. I hadn't played at that level for 2 years, so to get a chance to play with all the great players again, I suppose I was buzzing like a rookie, but... now, when you're playing with the best players going around, it's pretty easy to fit in at halfback and look pretty good.
Well, stick around over there, don't go anywhere, because we might need to get back to you down the track as the evening progresses. But would you please thank Andrew Johns and also Matt Frelingos.
Representative Player of the Year. New South Wales and Australian second rower, Nathan Hindmarsh. New South Wales winger, Matt King. New South Wales halfback, Andrew Johns. And New South Wales and Australian fullback, Anthony Minicello.
What a list of players that is. Libby, would you do us the honour?
The Dally M Representative Player of the Year for 2005 is Andrew Johns.
Once again, the Dally M Awards goes global. We cross back over to Warrington in England. Andrew, I didn't think we'd be talking so quickly, but in a career where you've achieved so much, what did it mean to be playing in this New South Wales side to victory in the Origin Series this year?
I felt blessed to be given the opportunity again. It's not until you're not involved that you realise how much it means to you. So it's great to get back into camp, and I spoke before about playing with the best players. Just loved it.
It will be ironic, of course, if the Rep Player of the Year for the Dally M's isn't available for Australia in the Tri Nations Tour at the end of the season. Will there be any regrets about this stint with Warrington if you're unavailable for Australia?
Oh, mate, I'd love to. You know, I'd love to tour with the Aussies. It's the ultimate, and no one's more proud than myself when I pull the green and goal on, but it's an opportunity, once in a lifetime opportunity, something I've always wanted to do, to come over here and play, and that's what I'll be doing for the next couple of weeks. So if it comes to that, we've just got to make the decision down the track.
Just very quickly, while we have you, what are you expecting out of this stint over there with the Warrington Wolves? Can you lead them to a bit of glory over there?
I don't know, mate. I'm just looking forward to the challenge. I haven't really met anyone yet from any of the players. I just arrived this morning, met the coach, Paul. Start training tomorrow, and then, you know, we're on against Leeds, world champions, on Saturday night. So it'll be a good gauge on how I'm going Saturday night, but fingers crossed we can go to the big one on October 15.
And we'll see that game, of course, on Sunday morning on Fox Sports. Andrew, you're a two-time winner so far tonight. Stay with us. There may be a third coming your way.
Thanks, mate.
Andrew Johns, and you also, please put your hands together once again for Libby Lanton.
Hooker of the Year. The nominations are Danny Badiris, Robbie Farah, Dean Young, and Cameron Smith. And the winner is Danny Badiris from Newcastle.
Well, Betsy, things weren't looking bright for the Newcastle Knights at the start of the year. You lost your first 14 straight, but you must have been particularly happy with the way the guys finished the season.
Yeah, it's a springboard for next year. We've got a couple of handy players coming again next year, and we've kept everyone that was off contract this year. So we're looking forward to next year.
You're not involved in this year's semi-final, so you can give us your honest opinion. Who do you think will take it out this year?
Yeah, we played them on Sunday. I think if they're stay-injury free, I think St George will go very close to win it, and they've got a great team, and good luck to them.
Well, congratulations on your form, and all the best in the Tri-Nations Test Series later on in the year.
Thanks a lot, Star.
Danny Badiris there with Laurie Daly, of course, in conjunction with Andrew Johns, the two stars of the Newcastle Knights, and we hope Australia in the Tri-Nations Series later on this year. But Jonathan Thurston leads by three to Andrew Johns and Ben Kennedy. Now, we saw Andrew Johns watching on and listening on over there in Warrington. Let's go back over to England now as the Dally M's once again goes global. Andrew, how are you feeling at the moment, of course? So close, and with three rounds still to remain. Do you think you're any chance?
Yeah, I don't know. I'm just trying to think who we played in the last three rounds, but I think Jonathan Thurston or BK deserve a winner, so I don't know. Fingers crossed.
It was so remarkable, Newcastle's second half of the season. At any stage, did you start thinking about maybe your fourth Dally M and trying to work out how many votes you'd picked up in those last 10 rounds?
No, I didn't, mate, to be honest. I was sort of worried about trying to keep that winning streak going, but I think the last two rounds someone got me in, said, and then I thought back a little bit, but yeah, I honestly didn't think I'd be that far up, so touch surprised.
Well, don't go anywhere. Still a few rounds to go, and we'll see if you can peg back that three-point lead of Jonathan Thurston.
Andrew Johns continued to steer the Knights away from the wooden spoon as Newcastle put the cleaners through the Sharks, who went from 62-point winners to 30-point losers in the space of a week. And the Storm sent a warning shot across the bow of the title contenders as they broke the Tigers' 8-game winning streak. Halfback Matt Orford starring as Melbourne celebrated their final home game for retiring captain Robbie Kearns.
Here we go. 7 players in the top 10 polled votes in round 25. Brayton Astor against the Panthers, 1 vote. Stacey Jones against the Seagulls, 2 votes. Craig Gower against the Bulldogs, 3 votes. Ben Kennedy against the Warriors, 3 votes. Scott Prince against the Storm, 1 vote. Andrew Johns against the Sharks, 3 votes. And Jonathan Thurston against the Rabbitohs, 3 votes. What a response by Jonathan Thurston in round 25, 3 votes against the Rabbitohs. He has once again vaulted in front of Andrew Johns, who after picking up 3 votes himself had skipped 2 points clear. Ben Kennedy, unfortunately, now out of the running, the Manly Seagull great. He is there on 25 points. Scott Prince also now can't win the Dally Medal for 2005. He's on 24. Brett Hodgson, 22. Craig Gower, Stacey Jones, Matt Orford, Shane Webke and Brayton Astor. All still there. But ladies and gentlemen, here at the Sydney Town Hall and watching live, of course, on Fox Sports, we have a race in two. And for the first time with the Dally M Awards, it's a race that crosses the globe, of course, with Andrew Johns watching and listening on from Warrington in England. Now, we don't need to see any highlights from round 26. Let's go straight to the votes. David, what did the judges have to say for round 26? Round 26, Andrew Johns against the Dragons, 3 votes. And with 3 votes against the Storm and the winner of the 2005 Dally M, Jonathan Thurston.
First, our weekly editorial with the Courier-Mail's Mike Coleman.
At last, the business end of the season, and Australian Rugby League fans have the chance to see the best player in the world trying to get his side into the grand final. Unfortunately, he won't be doing it here. Anyone wanting to watch Joey Johns play this September will have to catch the replays of his games from England. Does anyone find this a little strange? The greatest draw card in the NRL not only missing from the finals, but missing from the country. How's this for a solution? If the English clubs can sign Joey after the Knights are knocked out of the comp, why can't the Australian clubs? He's not playing for Newcastle, so why can't he play in the finals for Manly or Cronulla? For that matter, why can't he play for Manly and Cronulla? Then, when he gets them both into the grand final, he plays one half for each club. Extra time could be a problem in the event of a draw, but look on the bright side. At least it would give those Sydney League riders a reason to keep getting out of bed in the morning.
And we are coming up to where defence wins matches, even more so now. And some wonderful, desperate defence online last weekend. Yeah. Two of the best tackles that I've seen all season. What about this one, Milton Thaiday on Jason Rice?
Go, Milt!
How do you stop Jason Rice
perfect
from scoring?
Just the perfect tackle, that was.
Like, it's little man against big man. He's 3 metres out. He's on the fly.
How embarrassing for Jason Rice.
And what about this one from Steve Southern? Matt King, bang. In he comes. Okay, I hope we get another shot of this one because he flies in from left to right. Crunch.
And he's so close, Matt King, and he's such a big bloke, he knows how to find the line. Without his input, that was definitely a try.
I've got a prediction, boys. Milton Thaiday, what a phenomenon. What a player. I think, honestly, next year, Milton Thaiday, with the off-season under his belt, I think he'll compete with Minicello for the Origin fullback. That's I think he's that good.
Now, last week we had Andrew Johns on the show. Of course, he's winged his way
to play for Warrington coming up on the weekend. But we sent one of our personal friends out to assist him on his journey, Andrew Johns.
Boys. How are you, Barjas? Hey, son, I thought I'd just give you this to pass on to the boys at Warrington. Let them know what you're all about. Is that all right?
Yeah, it's fine.
Hey, cheers, been a one-way ticket. Come on, son, I'll see you out of the country.
Thanks, Reg. Divin, you must be coming out, are you looking for some publicity?
Yes, mate, you got it right. I'm going on the flight just to massage his legs, deep vein thrombosis, that sort of thing. Yes, ladies. And just got a couple of tits here. I've got a one-way ticket to Manchester via the Ukraine. Excess baggage, I reckon. Yeah. And a bit of hand luggage as well.
It's disappointing, but look forward to next year now with the Knights.
It's one of the biggest challenges of your career, Joe. Linking up with your teammates that you've never probably seen play.
Yeah, it's a big challenge.
I'm doing the staple diet in England's fish and chips and Yorkshire pudding. We expect to see you come back through customs about 180 kilos.
I don't want to answer your question.
Go on, son.
Thanks, Reg. Fairly simple style of play, so hopefully I can get in there and add something.
And what are your expectations for this trip?
Well, good games over there. To make a big impact on the side. Play the best football I can individually.
Have you thought about Tour Nations yet?
No, that's after that, so we could have this one.
It's pie in the sky stuff, isn't it?
Okay.
Thanks, Joe. Thank you. Give him three cheers, eh? Three cheers for Joey. Habib? Habib? You want your son, we'll miss you. See you later, Barjas. Good luck and good riddance.
Camera off. That just proves that Reg, despite how tough he is only human.
There is a soft spot. I mean, Joey and Reg, it's a love-hate relationship. Bordering on hate, but still love-hate. But look, news on Joey. I was having the yard with him this afternoon. Train with the Warrington boys. They're very confident. And our 25-1 looking very good fans.
Tell you, what do they call themselves?
Warrington Wolves.
The Wolves, OK. And also, we started our five best-ever grand final moments last week. This week, it's up to number four.
The top five grand final moments. Number four.
They're 2 metres from the line. Kamali puts the kick over the cross. There's a try coming. Craig Smith. Craig Smith has put it down. Has he put it down legally?
Oh,
was he onside?
Well, hang on.
Did he get it down?
What about the high tackle from Ainsgate?
He got absolutely hammered.
This could be a penalty try.
Yes.
All right, OK. You're having a look at... Does this bloke ground the ball? You have a look at how he's fouled.
Well, looking live at the incident, I had a very strong doubt that it was going to be a penalty play.
Well, Chris Ward, the video referee, becomes the most important player in this match right now. Here we go. He gets the ball first, gets hit around the head, and drops the football. What to do? What does the video ref do? Does he award a penalty try?
Well, can you be absolutely certain that Craig Smith would have scored?
No, he's taking him out of the throat.
Yeah, that's a penalty try.
This is the biggest call I think I've ever experienced in rugby league, and I've been calling it for 34 years.
That's very exciting. It either wins or loses in the game.
They know how important this kick is, and Matt Guy has kicked it. Matt Guy has kicked it. The grand final party has come alive in Melbourne.
News on Joey Johns. In England, he's declared that he won't be coming home if Warrington make the grand final. That means Australia may have to look for a new test halfback, possibly Scotty Prince. The game against Leeds, where Joey's making his debut, is a sellout. I caught up with Joey just before he left for England and asked him if he could be joining Warrington in 2008.
No, this is my only chance of playing over there. I've always had a dream to play there, and this is the perfect opportunity. I'm off contract at the end of 2008 with Newcastle, and that'll be it for sure.
In case you haven't caught up with the news overnight, Andrew Johns made his much-awaited debut for the Warrington club. They won the match 33 points to 16. Andrew Johns had a hand in three of the tries, kicked five goals, and got the man of the match. So, I mean, there he's flown in about 2 days ago. How good is he?
In the first half, Leeds, well, they're thinking that he might be a bit jet-lagged. They sent plenty of troops his way. He just kept picking them up and driving them backwards. His kicking game second half was just superb. Set up a try with a little jink and put one of his teammates away. Look, he's gone there under pressure because he is the world's best, and he's just confirmed it again.
Yeah, he'd be the best player that England's seen for a couple of decades at least.
His last batch of, like, 10 weeks of footy has been the best I've seen from anyone ever. Like, you know, you really got to start wondering where this bloke's going to sit in the history books and all that. I think this is a great thing for him. It's a challenge. It's something that I suppose people at the top of their, you know, whether any sport, you know, they need these sort of things. So I can see only good things coming out of
this.
Does
that give you itchy feet? I mean, I know you've been retired a year, but I'm sure you had offers to go to England. No chance?
No, not really. I think I found a challenge at the Roosters, and I think that was the important thing for me. I really found that the last couple of years. And I think the last couple of years, which I said before, emotionally my easiest. I think I was a little bit smarter. And you really see the way Joey's playing at the moment. He's just so far ahead of everyone else, you know, with his brain, yeah. And it makes it so much easier for himself.
You had a massive offer to go there, though, didn't you?
Yeah.
When you retired, you had a massive offer to go to England and rejected it. Yeah.
His next game will be against Hull, where Sione Famuina has gone for a short stint. Yeah. Adrian Morley, also the other NRL player to go across there. I think it'll be the last time we see this happen, but those three have taken up the opportunity.
Overseas, they're saying he's worth every penny. That's what they're saying in Warrington after Joey Johns wove his magic in the English Super League debut for the Warrington Wolves. He's that good. His presence lifted his new side to an upset 33-16 win over the Leeds Rhinos. The world's best player carving up the defence with fancy footwork, while at times his kicking game was just simply astonishing. No one was able to work out how he get this long-range punt to stop in goal.
Well, he could not possibly have hoped for a better start than this.
To cap it off, Johns kicked five goals from six attempts, and surprise, surprise, he collected the man of the match. How good is he?
Andrew Johns has more than earned his money in England with a man of the match performance in his debut for Warrington against Leeds.
There he is, the man we all want to see.
Johns was involved from the kickoff. A long pass helped out Henry Farafeli away. There were sideline conversions that never looked like missing. And the longer it went, the more Joey dominated. Warrington won 33-16, moving to third on the English Super League table.
Andrew, who writes your scripts?
Yeah, I don't know. I had great work. That so much hard work went into it, and every player out there was so brave. And
may have claimed the wooden spoon, but star halfback Andrew Johns was the hot tip to win this year's Dally M medal. But 6 weeks out due to injury cost him the award. North Queensland's Jonathan Thurston taking the honours, winning by just the one vote over Joey Johns.
Absolutely terrific. Joey Johns, to have done so well, having only played half a season, was incredible. But Jonathan Thurston is a young buck for North Queensland.
Yeah, he had a great series.
Had a fantastic season.
State of Origin, and he can really play the game.
And thoroughly deserved the award, and he was as nervous as hell. God, I was shaking for him.
Yeah.
He was up on stage, he could hardly
contain himself. I mean, the story, Fitzy, you know? The salary cap, Canterbury had to let him go. How lucky was he?
Yeah.
Look where Canterbury are. Look where he is.
What about Andrew Johns? What about this bloke who only played half a season? What is it? Did he play that phenomenally well that he deserved to have second
origin? He plays the game
just the romance
on
of
another
Joey
level.
Now.
I mean, he's like the Roger Federer of rugby league. He's just
extraordinary
way out there.
Fish, they lost 14 in a row, right? Then he comes back from injury and they go on a winning streak, and on every occasion, it's no favouritism here. Mm. The game hinged around Joey Johns.
It's incredible,
yeah, I'll tell you what, really? There was a very unfortunate column written back in May. Somebody saying, look, you know, got the broken jaw.
sure, doesn't that show he shouldn't have come over to rugby? I mean, who would that poor dickhead be?
Yeah, I don't know.
It was well,
he
inspired.
He came back and inspired the Blues to win the State of Origin. Mm. He's inspired Newcastle, a series of extraordinary performances. And now, as you say, over there in Warrington.
Oh, he's a show off, Mike.
He seemed to get it over pretty quick. He starred for Warrington in his English Super League debut over the weekend, earning man of the match honours in his side's 33-16 win over reigning champions Leeds.
It's interesting the footage of Johns when you see him. You know, like Campese would do a sidestep and Papworth would do a sidestep where it'd be a yard here and a yard there.
Yeah.
Somehow with Johns, it's a jink somehow, but he doesn't lose any pace as he does it, but it's mesmerising to watch.
Yeah, I know what you mean. It's not quite as sort of stark as a Campese.
Great champions have the second and third move that bamboozle the opposition. Like, good players have that one move. It becomes a signature move, and sometimes the opposition becomes predictable, but these great champions have that.
Yeah.
That didn't work, I'm back this way.
Yeah.
And that's pretty expensive. Yeah,
or am I going to pass it? Am I going to pass it? And you hold off and you hold off, and all of a sudden you either do or don't. And you've
the seed of doubt fits you.
Yes,
which is
exactly
what you bring to this panel.
The seed of doubt.
Nice one. In the UK, at Warrington's Halliwell Jones Stadium, Andrew Johns made his debut for the Warrington Wolves, and yes, the game went according to the script. How else could it turn out with Andrew Johns playing a starring role? Came up with a high kickoff, Pat Richards style, hang time if you like, off the kickoff. They get the scrum, and within the side the first 60 seconds, what do you know, they're in.
Great performance, wasn't it, by Andrew Johns? I don't think anything surprised any of us the way that he was going to play. Look, I always thought he was going to be too good for Leeds, and Leeds are coming second in that competition. So I think Warrington are certainly on a winner. Also great to see a packed stadium. And Joey's been quoted to say he was very nervous before the game up there around State of Origin. He was that nervous. But what about that for a field goal? Just potted it over there. You see man of the match on the screen. But his skill level was far superior to any thing that the English supporters and also players have seen before.
Well, he has a lot of time to put his plays into action in the NRL, which is a lot faster game. So he goes over there to the games that are a lot slower, and you know, he's just got all the time in the world to do what he wants. So there's no doubt he's going to just continue to be outstanding.
You'll see him in action again this weekend, of course, when they play Warrington over there. There are the times, live 4:30 a.m. Eastern on Saturday, and also the replay there as well. And you can also check out scores and other news on foxsports.com.au as well, the website.
Saturday morning at 4:30, Warrington's charge to the semis continues when King Joey leads them into battle against Hull. Can the Wolves keep Hull from the door and out of the four? It's a last round showdown between the fourth and fifth place sides.
There's more people talking about rugby league in this town now than ever before.
Hull, Warrington, live at 4:30 Saturday morning. Replay at 5 p.m. exclusive to Fox Sports 1.
The assault on Old Trafford is underway.
I want to move on to success for the Warrington Wolves on the weekend with Andrew Johns making his debut. Of course, you coached for St Helens, Gateshead and also Hull over there in the UK Super League. What did you make of this debut by Andrew Johns?
Well, absolutely sensational. You know, I've been saying for a few games when Newcastle have been chipping away and winning, and we'd been winning, and you think, please go away, somebody beat them towards the end. You know, someone said to me, surely one player can't make a difference. Well, they can. Andrew Johns can make a difference to any team. He just wins games on his own. Do you know, that's the first time they've had a sellout at Warrington. So this is a new stadium. This is the second year they've played at the stadium, the Halliwell Jones Stadium. Holds nearly 14,000 people. It's the first time they've done it. So that's what Andrew Johns brings to the game. They're playing Hull this week. This is a big match for them because Hull and Warrington will finish either fourth or fifth, depending on who wins the match this weekend. And the significance of that is the team that finishes fourth gets the home tie against the fifth team, and third play sixth. They play a top six system. The top two sides get the weekend off, and they only have to win one game in the second week of the playoffs to go to the grand final. So it's real interesting over there what's going to happen.
You still sound like you're coaching in England there, Bomber, with the ties and what's the biggest difference in
intensity?
The English Super League compared to the ARL?
Intensity week in, week out. The English competition still relies heavily on overseas players. They still rely a lot on their Australian, Kiwi-type players, the Islanders. But the intensity week in, week out, there's a lot more parity, if you like, here in terms of I just heard Tim say before about you turn up now and you're not sure. You know you've got to play 90% plus to win a game. Over there, you can still be 70, 75% at top of the table side, will still easily beat a bottom half of the table team. And that's probably the difference. It's week in, week out. You haven't quite got that intensity, but it is getting better. And I think a lot of that's to do with the overseas players.
Andrew Johns about to get this game underway. He's a legend, according to Peter Sterling. He says he's the best halfback ever. A one-club man, his Newcastle Knights career began in 1993. 225 appearances for them so far. 23 caps for Australia, 23 appearances for New South Wales. He's won two World Cups, twice the winner of the Golden Boot as the best player in the world. Now he chases a Super League Grand Final. We're underway.
Welcome back to Main Game, and we'll see how Andrew Johns fared in his English Super League debut a little later. All right, let's see if our NRL experts are up to the challenge. And it's the start of what could be one of the most amazing cameos in English Super League history.
Yeah, it sure was, Casey. It was only a couple of days ago that Joey Johns, the great master from Newcastle, made his debut for Warrington on that short plane stint over there in Lancashire. The incident you talk about was the kickoff to the game, actually in front of a full house over there at Warrington. Little Rob Burrow, the halfback for the opposition side there, Leeds, drops the ball. And from the ensuing scrum, long ball from Johns, it gets out wide to the flank. And that's Henry Farfield, the old Warriors winger, goes over in the corner.
It was they were 25-1 to win the premiership before he signed. They suspended betting and now they're in the fours.
And they'll win it.
Well, Fox Sports will be keeping track of Andrew Johns' progress in the English Super League. His next match will be live this Saturday at 4:30 a.m. Hull versus Warrington, live on Fox Sports 1.
Well, of course, it wasn't just a big weekend of footy. It was a big week, of course, in England with Joey Johns' magnificent man of the match performance. Well done, Joey. He guided the Warrington side to a 33-16 victory over Leeds, who were on top of the competition.
It's quite amazing the pressure that Andrew Johns has faced this year. Like, you consider when he got named.
Reggie, special guest there in England.
Yeah, he was over in England.
In the crowd.
For the match.
Oh, loving it, Reg.
Yeah, talk about the crowd. It is just amazing. As Pete was saying, you know, he absorbs all pressure.
Go.
There he is everywhere. But boys, they sold 2,500 jumpers with the number 31 on them on the day of the match. They're absolutely loving Joey up. It's great for rugby league. And again, front and back pages.
And it wasn't just the footy, it was the cricket as well. Congratulations to England. Well, they were just too good for the Australians. They played really well. And, you know, Kevin Peterson, the star, 158. And he's everywhere, Rich.
Mate, he's everywhere.
International.
He's got some frequent flyers.
Absolutely loves it. He's going to catch up with Johnny Knoxville a little later. That's a partnership made in heaven. John Knoxville, Reg Reagan. Looking forward to that.
Now, speaking of grand finals, a couple of weeks back we started out what we thought were the five most memorable moments of grand finals over the last 15 years.
87, is it? Get a run?
No, mate, no. Our first one was 92, Steve Renoff, length of the field try. Our fourth one was the 1999 penalty try awarded to Craig Smith. And as I say, to take us to the break tonight, here is number three in the countdown, our greatest grand final moments.
The top five grand final moments. Number three.
I just remember the ball coming off Freddie's feet, really, and Freddie passing it to and Todd Byrne, and I thought Luke Lewis, our winger, you know, had him quite covered, but you know, Byrne got away, and my first thinking was really just to take off, and I thought Reece Wessa was sort of probably behind me, and I thought if I can get to him from going around under the goal post, I can maybe stop a 6-point try. So that was my first thinking, but sort of as I sort of gathered a little bit of momentum, I sort of got a little bit closer to him and realised I was half a chance of getting them. And being a wet night, I thought, well, if I get anywhere near his legs, I might be able to sort of put him a little bit in a touch. I'm happy to sort of person to go through your career and play however many games you have and be happy with that. But to be able to do something that in a game like that that sort of stands out a little bit, makes you a little bit chuffed, I suppose. I suppose the more you see the happiness on my young bloke's face, I think it makes it all worthwhile.
We've got a bit of street talk action now. Now, Reg Reagan, of course, he's gone out and done a bit. The Swans are playing on Friday night. I wish the Swans all the best. Join your boys. They take on St Kilda on Friday night. Reg has gone out and to ask about the Swans. So we had to get a man to talk about Melbourne. So who better to get than Sam Newman? Here's Reg and Sam.
The Storm, sir. What do you reckon about the Storm?
Somebody control the weather, you know.
So
we've got a mildly amusing game in town on Friday night. The Swans versus the St Kilda Saints.
Okay. Yep. Well, I think the Swans will win that one easy, but getting back to the Parramatta game, I think that she wins against the Swans.
What do we have to do to knock over the St Kilda?
Oh, we have to play some tactics.
What sort of tactics?
Get our forwards going and get our fullbacks getting them back and all that. Yeah.
So, just rip into the bastards,
yeah,
don't we?
Hey? Yeah.
Hey, you love it, don't you, son?
I love it.
Hey, how good is it, son? What advice would you give to Paul Roos for Friday night?
Paul Roos, kick a few goals and make a few plays, eh?
No, he's actually the coach.
Is he? Stop touching the boys.
Mate, I'm about to start Farragon for the Storm. It's a Storm, isn't it?
Well, of course it's a Storm. Yeah, well, what do you think it was? You be going up to watch them play, get in the car and drive up?
No.
Yes, appreciate your candor, sir.
He's a young Sydneyite. She's just bubbling with enthusiasm because the Swans are going to kick some serious on Friday night. Am I right in saying that?
Yeah, they're definitely going to kick some ass.
Yeah.
They can't lose.
Yeah. Yeah. Cool. Whatever, yeah.
Everyone down here is just chatting about it.
Not really.
We're getting excited. It's getting closer. It's only a couple more sleeps before they go through their work.
That's good.
Yeah, what do you like about the way they play?
I don't really get into rugby.
Well, look at this bloke, eh? He's an old throwback from happy days. He's got a really strong arm. He's got a strong arm, mate. There you go. I'll tell you what, he might have done his ass on a punt as well.
Do you know what the grapple tackle is?
No, I don't follow much of rugby.
Maybe the young lad has done it here once. You get someone round the neck and they bang them down into the ground.
Okay, it's a bit rough.
It is rough.
It is rough.
You know, all we're very, very, rough. Very virile people down here.
We do the Pilates, what is it, the Pilates one? The thumb in the bum, mate. We do that one.
If it's done on a man, it's called a Pilates. If you do it on a woman, it's called the six pack.
Sam Newman, been a Melbourne girl, what do you think of?
Spunk.
Spunk,
hey? I was joking.
Nah, that's all right. Apparently he's on the lookout for another girl.
Oh, is he? Yeah.
You might be a little bit too old, though. Hey, Swannies versus St Kilda. Could be a big clash, dude.
Is it? Where are the Swans from?
The captain of the Storm,
isn't he? Is it Robbie Kearn?
Are you still bubbling after Friday night? They had that amazing win. What was his name? Nick Davis, that cute, young cute guy?
I don't know.
Yeah.
No, we watch our league only.
Ah, league only
league
girls.
League only.
Okay. Yeah. So that's where you probably recognise me from, being an old Newtown Jets man.
That's it. I'm Fatty, we're glad you're back. We love you.
Yeah. Now we're talking to the AFL footy show this time. Oh, so say something to Sam Newman.
Oh, okay. Hi, Sam.
Wanker. Yeah.
And our thanks to Sam Newman as well.
Yeah, really good people. And we want to, and look, seriously, it's a rugby league show. We want to wish the Swans all the very best for Friday night. Hope they kick it above, mate, the grand final. Join the boys.
Now, new movie started today, The Dukes of Hazzard, and it stars Sean Someone Scott and Johnny Knoxville. Now, Johnny Knoxville, of course, is Jackass. He's in the movies and he plays one of the parts in this movie. He's a character. He's been out sitting for a few days. Anyway, I don't think he stopped drinking for those 3 days. And who better to catch up with than Reg Reagan? Here's Reg and Johnny.
He's going to be
first time in Australia. You want to taste our iconic drop. Wow. Now, this is called KB Lager. Wow. Maybe we just crack one and have one.
Cheers, man. Thank you very much. I was gagging for a beer.
Why don't you have a taste of that?
Yeah. Cheers.
It's real smooth Australia. I just want to ask you about Dukes of Hazzard. I mean, did you feel any pressure? Because in my books, Dukes of Hazzard, the series, was the greatest friggin' series of all time.
No, there's no pressure, man. And due to large amounts of alcohol, I didn't really feel much while I was filming this movie.
What gives you more satisfaction? You know, if you be Jackass Day, swimming in other people's turds, or being a film star?
I mean, I'm very happy to be doing what I'm doing, but I guess as silly as it was, it had a special place. What's left of it?
Johnny, here, please.
Oh,
just,
thank you, man.
Yeah,
I got
another take through here. Another one.
Oh,
man.
Thanks.
Yeah, no
problem
at all. Turned
out to be a really good interview.
Oh.
You gotta commit.
Oh. John, I guess I'm just not Dukes of Hazzard material.
Oh, that's all right. You got great legs.
This is real Australian culture. This is called King's Cross.
A lot of gorgeous women in Australia.
Yeah.
Just when you thought you saw the prettiest, another prettier one will walk
right
by. Oh,
look at that one there.
Oh, boy.
Wow, that's a guy, actually.
What's Club X?
Oh, it's just a place you get some good reading material.
Oh, all right.
Porkies.
Porkies, that sounds... Oh, my. I don't even know what to say.
There's a lady there.
Ish?
Yeah.
Boy, it's great working with Willie Nelson, let me tell you.
Willie's a great guy.
No, actually, Willie's amazing.
Sucks or good just, guy?
No, Willie's the coolest guy, period.
Actually, we're going to pull over by the police.
Are we really getting pulled over by the cops?
Yeah.
We better take the evidence.
Hey, guys.
Wow. I don't have any money, officer, but if you search me, I'll write you a check. Absolutely. Wow, she's pretty.
Oh, you've been drinking too.
Yes, ma'am.
Nah, it's all right.
How do you,
I'm joking.
Wow. Pleasure to meet you, sir. Nice to meet you. So I took everything in my pocket for no reason.
Well, we just have a journey.
I thought it was a setup, but it wasn't.
It's nice to meet you, man.
It's great to meet you, John.
Oh, man.
Enjoy yourself and...
Don't worry about that.
Keep it real, huh?
Keep it real drunk. Way to go, man.
Good. Johnny obviously had a bad headache and had to slip some pills and some Aspros.
I mean, for all the people out there, I mean, obviously they were Aspro clears, so.
So when I get a headache at home from now on, I have to ask my wife for some evidence.
Yes, that's right. Exactly. No, but he's a good bloke. Reg Reagan met his match there. But Johnny Knoxville, seriously, great sense of humour. It was a gag and a tremendous bloke.
And I saw the movie today. It's a good soundtrack. All right, Sterlo, what's the Jim Beam question? What's the trivia question?
I got no idea.
Well, it's a big game, this, for both these clubs. And, of course, the prize at stake is the chance to make it at least one home appearance in the playoffs that get underway next weekend. Now, we're going to meet one Hull star who's hoping to make it another special night at this ground for the Black and Whites. But there are no prizes for guessing whose name is on everybody's lips in Warrington just at the moment. It is, of course, after his sensational debut last week, Andrew Johns.
Nobody does it better. Makes me feel sad for the rest. Nobody does it half as good as you. Baby, you're the best.
He's been captivating audiences in Australia all his playing life. Now he's here doing the same for us.
Nobody does.
Genius. We are watching a genius tonight.
Do you have to be so good?
dazzling debut and darling of the fans to just another face in the crowd. Warrington's end-of-season dinner was a chance to celebrate the season-long achievements of the rest of the team. But after just one game, Andrew Johns feels like he's been with them all the way.
Well, the atmosphere of the crowd the other night is one of the most special moments I've had in my footy career. And it was honestly the best atmosphere I've played in front of. The noise of 14,500 was the loudest I've played in front of. You know, in Australia, we crowds of 80,000, but it's nowhere near as passionate and as loud as in the singing and stuff. It's just a special, special crowd. I'm proud to play for this club, and you know, I'm really honoured the way the club's taken me on board, and they've really welcomed me and my partner into the community. Everyone's been so kind to us, you know, in shopping centres and stuff, stopping us and wishing us all the best. So, yeah, I'm really proud to be and to represent the club. So over the next couple of weeks, I can play well and pay them back.
His arrival coincides with the impending departure of another Wolves crowd pleaser. Nat Wood said his goodbyes to the crowd at what could be his final game at the Halliwell Jones Stadium. It was an emotional moment.
I think it was only fitting, you know, for such a special night with Andrew coming and how built up the crowd were in anticipation of such a great game. So, you know, it finished perfect for all of us.
Ladies and gentlemen, the player of the year for 2005, the one and only Brent Gross.
But all the hard work will count for nothing if Warrington don't live up to their ambition this year. A win over Hull tonight is vital if they're to get that all-important home tie in the playoffs. Andrew Johns, for one, can't wait to get out of the suit and into his boots.
They're going to have a sell-out stadium, so it'll be a great atmosphere, and I'm sure they'll want to have a big win.
Love them coming to see you.
Really? Coming to boo me, probably.
If Andrew Johns is the hero in waiting, then there has to be an enemy planning to spoil the Wolves' party.
And, of course, our grand final moments. This week we're up to grand final moment number 2, and we take you back to 1990, and we'll see you after the break.
The top 5 grand final moments. Number 2.
Roy Simmons following out Alexander, knowing this is his final game. The roar will be huge for the minor premiers. Will this be their first ever title? 5 metres out. Guy up to Dunn. The switch. Simmons. Simmons up the middle. Righty Simmons. Simmons gets it. Great footwork. He will remember this for a long, long time.
Short drop outside Cameron and Everton.
It was, I think, the moment that really struck to me is when Greg kicked the goal with 30 seconds to go, and we knew we couldn't be beaten. You know, it was the blood pumped through the body pretty quick there, and the hairs on the back of your neck stand up, and you know you've won the grand final.
What a finish for Roy Simmons! What a champion he has been for his club. 258 appearances. What an exit from the game.
To all the Penrith supporters, all the sponsors over the years, for the 12 years that I've been there, thanks for your support. I hope to have a schooner with every one of you tonight sometime. Thank you.
After the grand final, you said you planned on having a beer with every single Panthers supporter. Did you make it?
Well, have a look at me, yeah. Yeah, I achieved it.
Footy show, and of course a big weekend of rugby league coming up. But I went and saw a movie today, a European
Gigolo, Deuce Bigelow. And it's very, very good. And the star of that movie joins us right now. Please, a big Footy Show welcome for Rob Schneider.
Paula.
Welcome, Rob.
Paul has a...
How are you, champ?
Paul has his saying, you know, goal. I got mine. You can do it! You know who can do it this weekend?
Tigers. The Tigers!
I'm sorry, I'm intimidated by Russell Crowe. I don't want him throwing a phone at me the next time. Go Tigers!
Thanks for coming on, Rob. How's Australia been treating you this week?
It's terrific, and you know, I got an announcement to make, Fatty. Can I call you Fatty?
Yes, whatever you like.
I have an announcement to make. I intend to buy the Newcastle Knights. I got $50. I got it on me too.
I'll tell you what, on me. $50, you'll get some change. How's that?
Now you're gonna get some letters from them. A letters to Fatty, please.
Yeah, some more letters, please. I could do with some more letters.
French ones.
Now this is, I went and saw this movie and I laughed at least three times. No, it's actually it's very, very good. It's very funny, and you are the star. And I must say, your co-star, the young lady, she was a very attractive young lady.
She's Hannah Verboom.
Yeah, worth. I mean, Rob's a good sort, but worth the admission price to see this young lady. We're going to have a look at just one of the scenes from the movie right now.
I don't want a man who's chiseled and sculpted. I like soft and weak.
You do?
I want a man who's unemployed. Kiss my chest.
Okay.
Harder. Bite me.
You sure?
Harder, bite me harder.
Get off of my titty, you dumb duck. Crack up.
He was eating space cake. In Amsterdam, I was high eating space cake.
Now, just take us through the storyline. Is the three of the great gigolos in Europe have been murdered, and you've got to find out who's killing them.
I got to find out who's killing the gigolos, and of course, I got to go back into the man-whoring business and kind of figure it out and go out with some crazy women. And it's Europe, so they're crazier over there. No body waxing whatsoever.
And some of the women that you had to... you know, with the business. One was 9 foot, one's got a hole in her neck.
Yeah. They're not the best looking women in the world, I give you that.
That's the whole thing,
you know, he thinks, Deuce Bigelow thinks he's gonna go out with these girls and they're gonna be great, but they're all horrible. So that's the kind of the fun of it, you know. Yeah. Even when he's in his hallucinations, he's a loser.
Yeah.
So that's kind of fun, you know.
He's a bit like the chief, really, yeah.
What about me and you before at the back telling stories and laughing?
It was more than fun, it was painful.
Now look, Rob's met a lot of great people in Australia this week, but none better than a bloke who spent some time with him today, good friend of the show, Reggie Reagan.
Now, the problem every footballer faces each off-season is what they should do to earn a quid. My tip is to do something you love, something you're passionate about. Unfortunately for Reggie boy, no one's going to pay me to smoke darts or drink piss. But seriously, we all know how much Reggie loves banging the birds, so I have decided to kill two birds with one stone this year and become a male gigolo. And to help me out, well, I've employed the very, very best. Hey, Juice! How are ya?
Hey, Reg, and it's Deuce, not the Juice. Deuce Bigelow, not the Juice Bigelow. Anyway, hey, I'm your fairy god pimp for the day. Huh?
Yeah. Huh? All right.
Anyway, you know, now selling your body's like selling any product, Reg. You know, it's all about packaging.
Spam?
Well, kinda. Anyway, you know, it's how you wrap it up, okay? Here, wrap this around your mangina. I don't know which side gives you. Figure it out.
Is that it?
No, hang on. You got a choice, the Portuguese chorizo or the Danish salami?
You're the boss, dude.
Think big. Go with the Great Dane. Now, your body is a tool. You gotta work it with confidence and precision. Fatty and the audience will be interested to know that while we were shooting that, one of Reg's twins fell out of the hammock, so.
Oh, I'll tell you what, Rob, he's still got the carpet burn as well.
No, but it was actually, you know, in a Speedo, you know, you did proud.
Yeah, for sure.
I mean, seriously, I think, you know, $5, $6, $7 is all right. You do all right.
Thank you very much.
Hey, Rob, you've been in a lot of movies, mate. Where does your movie career go from here?
Golly.
Anything you want to do especially?
I think maybe, you know, Deuce Bigelow Down Under. Maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're talking.
I'm open. You got any suggestions? I'm open. You know, Deuce Bigelow and Reg.
Yeah.
Sounds good. You got any ideas?
Well, listen. We're going to, Chief, you've vacated. We're going to play a bit of brain strain.
What do you got?
Jim Beam. So we need a punter from the crowd. We got one there? Blake and the St. George. Angelo, come on, Angelo, you're in.
All right, come on in, man. Nice to meet you.
Now, we're playing for some cold, hard cash. Chief's got thousands there.
A little bit of that.
Go Tigers.
Angelo, a little bit of each way there from Angelo, West Tigers cap on. We're going to play Brain Strain now. I want you to, we've got some special buzzers in tonight. Can we just take that off?
Yeah, and let's take a look.
Here we see. Go, reveal.
Ow! Perfect.
Now, believe it or not, if you when you answer a question, you actually have to push the cactus buzzer there, all right?
What do we got to do now?
Just push the cactus buzzer. Do you want to have a try?
Yeah,
just
all right.
Yep.
A little red thing in there, mate.
Ow! I'm ready.
They are real... Okay. That's it. Sweet. Righto, here we go. Okay. Ready to go, boys?
Gotcha.
Sort of.
Name Rob Schneider's new film.
Deuce Bigelow, European Gigolo.
That's it.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
it. Each question's worth $100. Each question's worth $100. So this is good. Name the capital of France.
Paris.
You'll get this one. Rob, just settle down.
I should announce my charity, by the way, right now.
Yeah, which is?
I'm playing for, hang on a second, the Platinum Tan Strip Club.
All right, name the Tigers captain.
Scotty Prince.
Yes, and that's right, yeah. Angelo, can you just test your buzzer again, please? Yeah, it's working.
All right. Come on, Angelo. Fire up, brother.
What international heartthrob went to Terra Nova High School?
Ow! Good God!
That's really bad.
This game is just taking a turn for the worse. that would be me, Rob Schneider.
Yes, you did. Now, what we're going to do now, just to make it interesting...
We are?
We're going to put some blindfolds on you.
No!
Yeah, oh, yeah.
Good
yeah,
God.
Yeah. This is good.
Yeah, Rob, let me just give you a hand in that.
Okay. There you go. Blindfolds on. Okay.
I'm just going to hold that on you, mate, okay?
Yeah,
next question. Finish the vinyl song title, The Pleasure and the...
Holy shit.
Pleasure and the holy shit. Haven't heard that one, no.
Pay and fat.
That's it, Reggie. What's the plural of cactus? Matt?
Cacti.
Cacti, yes.
Beautiful.
Yeah. Keep the record.
Which Home Alone film?
Slow Ben in the movie 16 again.
Which Home Alone film did Rob Schneider appear in?
Rob? Two.
Home Alone 2, Lost in New York, yes.
Home Alone
2. Who did Matthew Johns play in his first grade?
What?
Who did Matthew Johns play in his first grade debut?
Oh,
Yes?
A Newcastle Knights.
Yes. Yeah, we'll take that. That's who he played for. All right. Simple question. Who'd like $100?
What?
Me.
Angela, yes, you've got one.
What is it now?
Next question, who'd like $200?
What?
Me? Angelo, $200, yes.
How about $300?
That's $300 for you, yeah.
You can do it.
Name
shit!
The...
God damn, he turned it on me!
Name the Swans captain.
Oh.
Name the Swans captain.
Bruce something.
Yes, Bruce who?
Bruce Hall.
All right!
Yes!
That's his brother.
Some of this charity money is
going to go to these strippers, and they need those boobs.
They do. All right, Juice Bigelow is a man what?
Yeah. Gigolo.
He's a man
whore.
Whore.
Man ho. And here we go. Last question.
I'm bleeding over here.
Have you got a question?
Finish the lyric. That's the way.
I like it.
Ah, yes, you gotta like it. Chief, now Angelo's made 300.
There, there's 400. You taking it, big fella, on the town. Hey! Get into that.
And that money, courtesy of Jim Beam. I've got to tell you, the movie is very, very funny, and this man is a wonderful, wonderful actor and a great sport. Please thank Rob for us. Thanks, Rob.
And a good movie too. Get out and see it this week if you can.
Andrew Johns is expected to play for Australia in next month's Tri Nations after his English team Warrington was knocked out of the finals race overnight by Hull. Depending on how far Warrington progressed, there was actually some doubt over his availability for the national team. Johns managed to cross for a flashy try, but his side was outclassed by Hull in the Super League elimination final. There's a ripper try. Fellow Aussie Nathan Blacklock gave Warrington nightmares, bagging three first half tries. Hull dominated to win 40-6 and will now play Bradford.
Andrew Johns is now expected to play for Australia in the opening Tri Nations against New Zealand after Warrington lost its English Super League elimination match against Hull 40-6. While there was little joy for one Aussie star, a former NRL hero was among Hull's best. Nathan Blacklock crossed three times to help set up an 18-0 lead.
Blacklock for the hat-trick for Hull. And down he goes for the try for Hull.
In the second half, Johns gave Wolves fans a moment of hope. But in a lopsided knockout game, Hull hit back quickly and Johns will be home a lot sooner than he expected.
What about yourself, Toddy? I mean, you're what you call a school... Oh, there we see the crowd. That was a fan day, fantastic day out there. I mean, boys, one of the things that impressed me about the Tigers is the fact that all year you've really enjoyed yourselves. Has Tim Sheens encouraged that again this week?
Definitely. At times we almost feel guilty that we're enjoying it so much.
yeah, at times we can almost feel a bit guilty that we're enjoying things so much.
What I was going to ask you before, Toddy, you come from Arundale College, you're a schoolboy superstar. Mm-hmm. It's taken you a little while to fulfil your potential, but this year you've done that. How big an influence has Tim Sheens been on you personally?
It's hard to say. He's shown a lot of faith in me over the years, and he's given me a second chance here at the Tigers, and you know, hopefully we can repay him with the finals win on Sunday.
Now look, I picked up one of the newspapers this week, and who's on the back page? None other than Reg Regan. Obviously. Tigers SOS for Reg Regan. What's that for? To help them on Sunday night after the game, mate?
Mate, yes. Well, you know, I mean, they'd send an SOS just in case they got beat. He's the Mad Monday coordinator, so...
Sweet. Well, I'll tell you something else. Reggie has been out to the training, and here's Reg Regan at the Tigers training.
Turns I'm here, mate. I'm... Again, I was there for the Bulldogs last year, the Roosters the year before, Panthers. Hey, what do you want me to do with the boys?
Put a pair of boots on and we'll find a spot for you, big fella.
How you feeling, mate?
No? Very okay. Nervous, particularly with you around.
Mm. Yeah. Mate, as I always say to all the boys, I'm right behind you.
So that double foot step you do, that's good, but you can extend off it. Do it twice, maybe even three times. Like this. Jump, 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 and then run.
I love what likes your new young blokes. So you four blokes, Benji, Princey, Farrazy, and Hodsey. I love watching you just go around. You're so clever with the ball in hand. I mean, what's the secret?
We enjoy playing with each other. I know that.
I bet you do, you kinky bastards, eh? Young blokes these days, eh?
Who would have thought, back when I coached you in President's Cup at Balmain, that you were going to end up where you were?
Well, that's right, mate. I must have sustained a few knocks or had me hitting a few scrums, mate, because those days are just a blur.
Can't remember?
Nah. Sorry.
You, my man.
Thanks, Bench.
Hey. You've
got a great ass.
Oh, sorry, I said you've got a great step.
Go on, your son.
Look, I've won 5, 6, 7 grand finals. And, son, the best advice I can give you is to relax and enjoy it and don't... up.
Stand up. I just wanted to close your eyes and visualise for a second. You got them shut?
Yeah.
Just think about where you've come from, son. Yeah. All those years playing for the Maggies, coming last, people saying you're no good and all the rest of it. Now look at you, think of yourself now. Mate, you're a strong Greek machine. A Greek machine, a Greek steamboat. I don't know if there is Greek steamboats, but if there one, you're it, kid.
In the sheds before the game, I want you to sing to relax the boys.
What should I sing? Right?
Almost heaven, West Virginia, blue red mountains, shallow over river. Join in. Life is older than the trees, younger than the mountains, blowing like a breeze.
I'm not country. Familiar with that one.
Son, this week, what's the plan?
Oh, what's that?
Just relax and enjoy it. Let's just pretend it was a bed bug.
Pretend it was pinching.
Scotty, I mean, I'm the last bloke that likes blowing my horn. Oh, no, I've never even done yoga. But how much of help was I last week? Yeah, Reg Regan, I know you sent the SOS out to me.
Yeah, you're very much a massive help. I think, just the aggression. It's helped our forwards, especially my defence as well. I seem to be more aggressive these last few weeks.
Do you remember what I said to you just before the game? I did. That was one of the things I said. Yeah. And then I also said, get out there, son. Get the ball and run and run and run and run. And what did you do?
We kicked.
Exactly.
Henry,
do you take drugs, sir? Come on, we got to.
Well done, Reggie. Good man, Reg. And we've counted down over the last 5 weeks to our best ever grand final moments. Here's number one. The year was 1997.
The top five grand final moments. number one.
The heart is a blue.
I still remember it just like yesterday. The instructions were, I think the whole crowd was screaming out, field goal, field goal.
This is it.
End the charge.
Andrew Jones.
Here it is.
At that stage, I've run in a dummy half. I looked at Mark Hughes, who was on the blind side, and I said, stay on the sideline, and sort of whispered to Darren Albert, stay alive.
21 metres away. Down the blind, Andrew Johns.
Oh, you know, I took a risk, and luckily he come off. I don't think we would have. They would have lynched me up here.
He just takes off down the blind side, and I'm thinking, you know, what's going on here? Because everyone thought he was going to the field goal, and I guess all the Manly did too.
Inside.
I just didn't know what to do, and I wanted to run around and jump in the crowd and carry on, but I just stood there and let the boys just pummel me, and it was the biggest heel I got all day, I think, when the boys hit me.
6 seconds to go, and Albert has scored an incredible try. Newcastle has won Rugby League crown.
It was just a flood of emotions going through me. You might have didn't know whether to laugh or cry, and the whole crowd was screaming Newcastle. You know, I've never felt those emotions before. I don't think I'll ever feel them again.
The scenes of jubilation are not just on the ground. You should see them in the grandstand. And no doubt, they're dancing in the streets of Newcastle right now.
It does not get any better than that. It's a fairy tale.
One of sport's most magnificent moments.
And in 1997, who will ever forget the scenes when Newcastle winger Darren Albert scooted over underneath the post in the dying seconds to give the Knights victory. Big, hard man, Paul Harrigan, running around the stadium with tears in his eyes, saluting his fans in the grandstand. There is nothing better than winning a premiership with your mates. In fact, the most famous American football coach of all time, a man by the name of Vince Lombardi, once said, "A man's finest hour, his greatest fulfillment, is that moment when he's worked his heart out in a good cause and he stands exhausted on the field of battle, victorious. There is nothing better than winning a grand final." Good luck to both teams. Enjoy your grand final footy.
It was 1980 when Ronald Reagan was elected 40th president of the US of A. And his illegitimate half-brother, Reg, topped off the year, winning the most violent player for the Jets for a record third time, whilst recording a top 10 single, Coward of the County.
Everyone considered him Coward of the County. He never stood one single time to prove the county wrong. Mama named him Joey, but I just called him Badge Ass. Something always told me they'll prove a Badge Ass wrong. Come on, everybody! Promise my son not to do the things I've done. Walk away from trouble if you can. Come on! Well, please don't think you're weak. I didn't turn the other cheek. I hope you're old enough to understand. Son, you got a huge ass like Alex Chan. Come on! Yeah. Promise me, son, not to do the things I've done. Walk away from trouble if you can. If you can, really can. But they don't think you're weak.
Kim, have a look at this, people. Yeah! Look at this. We've got things going. What's got to the weather? I don't know. But look at those fairies. They're like Matty Bowen. They're a zigging and a zagging. And they're just loving life. Let's have a look at the scores. City over Parramatta. Liverpool over Penrith. Geez, a local derby. No love lost there. Okay, the psychotic chart. We got smoke going across to Sheepshagger land. And now we're going to have a big H going to go across that might land on Telstra Stadium tomorrow. Be careful. Let's have a look. Who cares about the national weather? People, I'll give you the weather that counts. Cessnock tomorrow. Beautiful, humid, 26 degrees. Mudgy, Kenny Sutcliffe territory. G'day to all Kenny's girlfriends out there, all two of you. 26 degrees and beautiful, unlike Kenny's girlfriends. But the one that counts, people, Telstra Stadium tomorrow. 23 degrees, but we'll get warmer as the day goes on. So make sure you peel off the layers, people. You want a tip for tomorrow? I'll give you one. Go the Tigers! Yeah! What's a leopard? Reg Reagan doing the weather. Yeah, it's going to be a warm one. Thank you, Reggie, for that.
Tim Webster's next with sport, and Andrew Johns, he's unlikely to be on that Kangaroos flight.
Yes, these signs are really not good for Joey. In fact, there are problems with the knee, more than that. In fact, more shortly. A knee injury has halfback Andrew Johns in extreme doubt for the Kangaroos tour to the UK. A final decision will be made tomorrow, but he's already considering the possibility of surgery.
Andrew Johns en route to yet another medical appointment. A right knee injury looks likely to rule him out of the remainder of the Tri Nations series.
It's sore just to walk on. Every step hurts. And you know, that's the thing, I can't train with the side. And you know, when I'm out there playing, I said before, I can't run at my full pace and I'm not making an impact.
Johns has been in visible pain at Kangaroos training over the past fortnight. A major concern is that Johns' knee is causing pain to other parts of his body.
He hasn't had 100% movement in his knee. That is now starting to create some problems with his back, with his hip.
Further examination of scans tomorrow will determine John's short-term playing future, which could be more surgery, followed by another rehabilitation program.
Get it cleaned up now, and you know, it might take a couple of months, but then I'll be right for training, maybe in December or January, and then look forward to a good year for next year for the Knights.
If Johns is ruled out, it'll be the third consecutive Kangaroo tour he's missed due to injury.
I'd love to get out of there again, but I've just got to be smart about it. I'm not 21, I'm 31 now, so just can't be pushing myself when I'm injured.
Rob Canning, 10 News.
Ken, with sport next, and you have some breaking news on Andrew Johns.
Yes, and it's not good for his Kangaroo tour plans, Mark. Big news is breaking in rugby league tonight. We can tell you that Andrew Johns' Tri Nations tour is over. The star halfback pulled out today because of his injured knee. It's now down to Scott Prince, Craig Gower or Trent Barrett to replace him.
It was obvious at training last week that not all was well with Andrew Johns. Nine News revealed then that Johns' knee was giving him trouble again. His situation wasn't improved by this, and late today he was ruled out.
Playing the other night, not being able to be at the pace on the game, and I've just got to be a bit honest with myself, and if I can't compete, then I'm no good for the team.
Joey perhaps could have been ruled out on Friday night, but he asked for this opportunity to make sure there was nothing structurally wrong with the knee. That'll come to a conclusion tomorrow.
And the way he described his situation today, touring wouldn't be good for his long-term future.
Yeah, it's sore just to walk on. Every step hurts.
While he was due to get a specialist's opinion tomorrow, the decision had already been made.
Get it cleaned up now, and you know, it might take a couple of months, but then I'll be right for training, maybe in December or January.
Late today, Knights doctor Neil Halpin and Australian doctor Hugh Hazzard consulted to rule Johns out. Despite intensive physiotherapy on his knee, he still can't straighten his leg and is suffering back and hip problems. Danny Widler, National 9 News.
Newcastle players are putting pressure on Knights management to make a call on the off-contract coach Michael Hagan. He's been courted by the Parramatta Eels for 2007, and the issue is causing uncertainty in both camps in the build-up to next season.
There were plenty of laughs as the Knights had some off-season bonding today. But the uncertain future of coach Michael Hagan, a far more serious topic. Players growing impatient wanting to know who's going to lead them beyond this season.
I'd personally like it sorted out before the start of the season. I don't know how the other players feel. I just think going into a season, knowing what the future holds, I think would be a good idea.
Newcastle prepared to wait until well into next season before deciding on re-signing Hagan.
You know, he's a great bloke and he's a good coach, and he's one of the main reasons I came here. You know, he's pretty easy to get along with. And, you know, hopefully they'll get a decision done sooner rather than later so we can get on with things.
Hagan chatting with Parramatta boss Dennis Fitzgerald at today's NRL annual conference. The Eels want him to replace outgoing Brian Smith. Hagan impressed by what the club can offer.
They've been a very professional club for a long time, and they obviously throw a lot of resources at their football team. And I guess any coach, you know, that's what you want, the best resources set up you can find.
Hagan not having to worry about bumping into Smith. The Eels' mentor, one of five coaches not to show, including the embattled Wayne Bennett. Seven captains also giving the conference a miss, and referee Tim Manders retired just 2 months after controlling the grand final. Adam Hawes, 10 News.